6 days left before the historic election, and boy, we have some big news to break for you tomorrow. I'm just going to leave it at that. But the Clintons are about to be caught red-handed taking money from foreign governments directly for policy, not just from donors. This is true espionage, and I'm going to leave it at that. But we've got that coming up tomorrow. We have our camera crew, David Knight, there on the scene in D.C. at the National Press Club on the Hill. And Danny Williams, the reported illegitimate son of Bill Clinton, is preparing to speak. The story is on Infowars.com and DrudgeReport.com from Radar Online. Of course, I knew this was going to happen a few weeks ago, but we were happy to see Radar publish it because that hits a whole other audience, and the National Enquirer will have it on its cover tomorrow. Danny Williams is asking for the blue dress for a DNA sample from Monica Lewinsky. So we've got that live feed. The press conference has just begun. Joel Gilbert, the filmmaker, is helping Danny and putting it on. So much is happening. This just creeped up on me yesterday. So we sent David as quickly as we could. There's been huge developments. Google caught in new WikiLeaks and other documents running the Clinton campaign, basically trying to fix algorithms. The biggest election fraud news ever broke with the program they're putting on voting machines to shave the votes. They've been caught red-handed. This is just all of it earth-shaking. But right now, let's go to the start of the press conference.
When we ask, we will receive. And when we ask, we will not ask amiss, but we must ask so that those things that we have asked for may come to fruition. Clearly it states in the sacred text.
Members of his family praying.
We are his children, my people who are called by my name. If they will humble themselves and pray and turn from their wicked ways, then he will hear from heaven and heal their land. This is our land. And every situation that we've gone through, it is because when we pray, and we pray diligently, God infuses us and answers our prayer. These blessings we praise you for in the matchless name of Jesus the Christ, our God and liberator. Amen.
Thank Amen. You.
Joel Gilbert.
Okay. Each of us is going to give all the folks here on stage are going to talk about their experience and their knowledge of Danny's story. I'm going to tell you how I became aware of Danny. First of all, my name is Joel Gilbert. I'm a filmmaker based in Los Angeles. And again, I want to welcome you and all the faith leaders and press who came here today. Some people know me for films I've made on Bob Dylan, Barack Obama, and Islamism, as well as Paul McCartney. I've made quite a few films. And I made a film about progressivism in America 2 years ago. It's my most recent film. It's called There's No Place Like Utopia.
By the way, folks, CNN, Fox News, you name it, and I'm told this is like 10 times bigger than the last press conference, which got 30 million views on five or six different platforms, 20 million on Danny's own site. Just amazing. And so this is a big deal, the information being covered here. And I'm very glad that this press conference, they're going to cover a lot of the background of the Clintons and things, so a lot of good gets out, you know, not just justice for, obviously, Danny Williams, but for everybody.
They were all regressing. And minorities particularly were suffered from these progressive policies. That's why I was so interested in Danny's story, because, number one, I have absolutely no doubt that he is Bill Clinton's son and Hillary Clinton's stepson. To me, Danny is the living embodiment of the progressives' poor treatment of minorities on every level. On a personal level, as a small child, he was abandoned by Bill and Hillary Clinton, and then he grew up in a very difficult urban environment in America where there were no opportunities and without a father. As WikiLeaks recently revealed, Hillary Clinton said she has a public policy and a private policy.
That's right, and the public privacy is called blacks predators, and the private policy is to call them the N-word. We'll be right back.
Let's talk about Danny Williams. How foolish can you be? You are not fooling me. You will have to come correct, or you're going to make the people upset. How can you neglect? That was kind of me.
All right, if you go to DrudgeReport.com on this Tuesday, 6 days out from the big grand election, if you go to DrudgeReport.com, you will notice in the top left-hand corner, these headlines. Clinton's son to make new announcement, more. Begs Lewinsky for DNA sample, live from the press club. Rap song Hillary. You just heard part of the rap song. The press conference started about 10 minutes ago. They're showing some of the video background and some of the testimony of Danny Williams previously. And then Danny is going to be part of the press conference, we're told. David Knight is there. The feed is linked on drudgereport.com, live from Press Club. And obviously we have it in our story, Bill Clinton's son, live at National Press Club, asked Monica Lewinsky for DNA sample. And you scroll down past the photo. We probably need to move the link to the top. You can see the ongoing press conference that is happening. Now, again, we hit the zeitgeist last press conference, 30 million views on the different Facebook and YouTube platforms, 20 million on Danny Williams. So we'll see what happens with this today. But regardless, you got CNN, you got Fox, you got all the mainstream media there being forced now to cover it. They did a dirty trick a few weeks ago on that Wednesday night debate. Was it Monday night? I forget. The point is in Vegas. And they came and said, oh, it's not allowed now. Get out of here. And most of the media left. So that's the type of tricks they play. But still, the information got out. But this just ties into the fact these people are covering up on so many fronts. Now, obviously, we've got big news today. And I was talking to folks yesterday and this morning, insiders. About as inside as you get, I'll just leave it at that. And there's big news on the Clintons, perhaps coming out tomorrow, probably tomorrow. I'm told tomorrow, but I just want to say perhaps. But it's the kind of thing that gets me short of breath. There isn't many things get me short of breath. Yesterday, Bev Harris on the broadcast, top election fraud expert, finding the big kahuna, the big enchilada, something bigger than her 20 years of work, and she's dropped most of the big bombshells. So huge, the total proof of the program being loaded in at the central tabulation centers on multiple platforms, multiple companies, multiple vendors, absolutely stealing the election. How America's elections are hacked, missing link discovered. And we put out like five different videos off the live interview yesterday, and they've got over 1 million views. That is not enough. And I'm not complaining. I mean, this is bombshell. But we've got a condensed 3.5-minute report that Josh Owens did that I'm going to air later in the broadcast that we need to do the maximum push because, let's face it, people have a 16 to 18-second attention span, lower than a goldfish. And so we have to get it out to those folks to understand they've been robbed. The proof is here. We've caught them here. We've caught them there. But this is the big, giant enchilada. And it's George Soros is involved, of course, and it's how they are going into the fractions, how they're going into the algorithm, and how they're doing it. They don't even deny it. They're hiding it in plain view. This is over the top. They can pre-program whatever you want. It takes about 30 seconds to do at the central tabulation center, or you jack in over the internet, and then all the machines sit there and vote the way you think, but then it sends it in, it's changed. But she discovered the flaw. Because a lot of states wanted this, and they've been talking about a paper ballot copy and a receipt. People want it. Almost all the companies have a function where when you vote, it takes a shot, a digital photo that's very hard for an algorithm to fake. It's easy to shave stuff in a computer, but not the image, not millions of images. And now that can be a recount power. Then she caught the companies having those destroyed the day after, digitally erased. So this is blowing their system wide open. That rap song you heard was by Free Knots, which are wearing Hillary for Prison shirts. Great patriots. Good rap music with a good message. That's exciting. Let's go to the Danny Williams press conference and see what they're doing right now. So speaking of the rap video, I guess we played it earlier. They're now playing it now. So we will check in with the Danny Williams family and more at this press conference. And then, obviously, we're going to have an exclusive interview with Danny Williams, the only, I guess, folks that are getting that after he speaks on the podium. We also have coming up in studio Kathy Shelton, who is here. And I appreciate having the courage to come here and do this. She, of course, was brutally raped when she was 12 years old, reportedly was in a coma. Hillary Clinton made jokes and laughed about the fact that she, you know, knew the guy was guilty, but he still passed a polygraph, which destroyed her confidence in a polygraph. And it just goes the type of people these folks are. Imagine if Donald Trump had done this. He wouldn't even be in this race, and he shouldn't be. Talk about cold-blooded and evil. It just adds to the pile. So she's going to be in studio with us. Then Gerald Celente, who's on fire, is coming back on. And then Paul Joseph Watson has a big pollster joining him today with some big exclusives coming up in the fourth hour from London, England. We come to you from deep in the heart of Texas, Austin. Now, I have been lacking in this so much during the broadcast that I have not even been plugging our sponsors, really, or our own products that fund this operation, and that's gotten us. I just had the accountant come over up for the show and show me the numbers, and they said, you're losing money right now, so you need to plug. You need to fund this big, expensive operation, obviously, that's having such a huge effect. So I want to thank all the listeners that buy the books, the videos, the water filtration systems, the nutraceuticals. These are great products, and we believe in the free market that selling high-quality products that people need that then also funds a message is a total win-win. And so they basically explained to me, they said, listen, you're selling a lot of T-shirts, but you're not making money on them. A lot of these T-shirts you sell at cost. Great, it's changing the world, but we've got to continue to fund the operation. So I rarely get a talking to, but I just got one because I get so out of control. I got Ted Anderson calling me up too saying, quit skipping the breaks. I mean, I get it. That's the owner of the radio network. I just get so obsessed here. So we are still running the special on the ProPure G2 King, their biggest stainless steel filter. Sits on a countertop, cuts all the garbage out. It's simply amazing. The very best system that I personally use. We also have some other apples and oranges units that are excellent as well, like the Alexa Pure and others. But it's 30% off right now at InfoWarsStore.com. Great deal. Best system you're going to find for the price. Amazing. A win-win. That's at InfoWarsStore.com. Also, we only have 24 hours left on the 30 to 40% off. Super high quality. Made in America. 25-year shelf life. Storable foods. Powered by My Patriot Supply. We have the full calendar of My Patriot Supply. We also have the full InfoWars Select category, and that's how we're able to go 30 to 40% off their entire spectrum of food. InfoWarsStore.com or call toll-free 888-253-3139. So, obviously, it's something you need. Non-GMO heirloom seeds, great Christmas gifts so people can have it in the spring. Great solar panel systems and controllers, shortwave radios, thousands of great items, survival items, you name it, so many great things. We have amazing, high-powered probiotic biome defense, the very best out there. We bring you the very best. Our sleep formula, the healthiest, the purest, the strongest, for $19.95. A bottle of melatonin of the same strengths, like $19 on average. This is $19 with eight other ingredients like L-tryptophan, valerian root, chamomile, lemon balm, and more. I was talking to Pat Riley, who has trouble sleeping sometimes, and he said, no, I take Knockout now. And it absolutely had the best sleep of my life. Well, it's amazing. We know the colored light bulbs. We know the TV time, the screen time messes with our melatonin, our endorphins, damages sleep patterns. This is all admitted. We're getting the wrong kind of light, folks. Sunlight outside is what makes you sleepy at night. That's the proper type of light we're designed for. The stuff we get indoors is really harmful. And so, quite frankly, I most nights chemically counter that. That's why you go out in the sun all day. You sleep so good at night. I don't need it those nights. But when I'm in here under lights all day long, I'm telling you, it is just imperative. InfoWarsLife.com for all the nutraceuticals. You can see all the amazing five-star reviews from third-party sites. There's BrainForce, Living Defense, Knockout, you name it. It's all there. But I would take advantage of the storable food. We don't do that very often. 30 to 40% off across the board. InfoWarsStore.com or 888-253-3139. We can answer all of your questions. Now, the press conference is ongoing. If you want to see that feed, it's on drudgereport.com on the left-hand side. Obviously, we're not going to be carrying a lot of it other than Danny Williams, and we're going to have an exclusive interview afterwards with Danny Williams that'll air later in the broadcast today. But people really don't complain, but sometimes when we offer a feed like this, folks say, well, carry the feed. Well, this is like multiple channels if you're a new listener or maybe a radio listener. Because there's some confusion. This is the radio/TV show. It's like Fox has Fox Business or whatever. When we have another event, then the stream, uninterrupted, commercial-free, is on InfoWars.com and DrudgeReport.com for everybody. It's like when we have debate coverage. We give live analysis over it. We have a feed dry without us talking. We have a feed with us talking. And sometimes it just kind of the discussion gets hijacked by that. And I know the general listener understands what's happening. Some people don't, or maybe the trolls just go in there and create all of that. But We're going to go to break. I'm going to tune into the press conference. We're going to come back. I think Danny's getting ready to come up there. And it's again, all being fused together here on this transmission, the big transmission. But then we have all the little side transmissions as well. Like I did two other Facebook mentions myself this morning. Those are now archived. They're on our main Facebook page. We really get into Facebook a lot because that's where we reach a lot of people that wouldn't be politically aware or involved. We're having huge inroads there. Very exciting time to be alive. Huge new WikiLeaks developments of Donald being accused of being a Russian agent. Even the New York Times admits it's pure bull. It's all coming up. We're covering the live Danny Williams press conference, the reported son of Bill Clinton, who wants a paternity test and wants the Monica Lewinsky dress DNA from Bill Clinton's disgusting semen. The bigger news is, again, the top link on drudgereport.com. Wiki's What's Next? And the word is from Kim.com and others, and a lot of other sources I have, that WikiLeaks does have the 33,000 emails and is set to drop it anytime in the next 6 days as we count down. That is a big, big deal. Obviously, a huge situation. Meanwhile, we have Podesta caught again, saying we have to dump all those emails. How many emails do we have from Podesta and Hillary's other chief of staff and all the rest of them saying, we've got to cover this up. We've got to get rid of this. We've got to erase all this. We've got to have lawyers go in and take it all out before we give it to Congress and the FBI. Open and shut. Trump keeps talking about bombshells, which I agree are probably the new 650,000. That the FBI's got and reopened the investigation. But we have stuff that, again, one of these things would have brought down Richard Nixon over and over again. But meanwhile, in Pennsylvania at Valley Forge, now attacking the key battleground states and even going into blue states in his final attack, working his butt off, Donald Trump is speaking live right now. Let's play some of that. Again, Donald Trump in Valley Forge.
We will rebuild our military, and we will rebuild our country. I'm not a politician. My only special interest is you, the American people. That's why I've done it.
That's why the special interests are all against him. You're idiots if you don't vote for him. Never been more obvious. Cut and dry, America's last chance to do this peacefully. Thank you. Truth is, most of the Democrats wanting to win, they hate Hillary. Hillary's a monster.
The guiding rule of the political class in Washington, D.C., is that they are looking out only for themselves. Only for themselves, with the exception of these few people.
And which then collapses the whole economy.
Staring me in the eyes.
They kill the whole golden goose.
They will say anything and do anything and cling to their power and prestige at your expense. I'm running to change and reverse decades of failure and to work with the American people to create generations of success.
That's what I've always said.
I'm running.
Okay. We're here to change things. We're not here to just be the underground and bitch all day. We're here to take the country back.
To our honesty, to our government, and safety to our communities. We need safety. And by the way, our law enforcement officials, these are great, great people.
Well, they're not perfect. They're sure a lot better than George Soros and Hillary. At least they're Americans. They're not out to get us. We're going to reform all this, but we got to get the globalists out of here first. They set the whole thing up. Our border is now wide open, they admit, the worst ever. Just disease, cholera, leprosy, it's all pouring across.
And we are going to give great prosperity to our economy. I want to go into our poorest communities and work on a national plan of revitalization, the inner cities. And I've been working with so many African-American groups. These are such incredible people. We've been talking about it, working on it. We're going to bring jobs into the inner cities. We're going to bring safety. We're going to bring education, good, good schools into the inner city. The spirit of the people in the inner cities is beyond the spirit of anybody. And it's going to work. It's going to work. You watch. Americans are tired of being told to defer their dreams to another day. But politicians, for the most part, really mean another decade because that's what they're talking about. Enough waiting, time is now. But to accomplish our goals, we must cut our ties with the small, bitter, petty politics of
exactly.
the past. We must declare our independence from a failed establishment that has squandered $6 trillion
all happening,
on foreign
folks.
Wars in the Middle East.
It's all happening.
That never end.
Evil is not invincible.
That we never win. And that have made us far less safe. Think of it. Think of all the money that's spent.
Americanism, not globalism. Americanism is the new idea. It's why everybody wanted to come here. It's what made us special. Globalism is old empire.
They've left our borders wide open at home and shipped our jobs and wealth to other countries.
Where they had deals.
It's time for new leadership.
It's time to lock their asses up. I want them to have jury trials, but we got to have espionage trials. There are at least 10,000 need to be arrested and put in prison. I'm serious. I don't say that vindictively. These are dangerous people. They're seditious. They're enemies. We're going to go to break. And come. By the way, Trump is planning to lock their asses up. This is going to be some dangerous fascism. They were pushing to shut our media down and arrest us for our free speech. Now we're going to arrest you for espionage. All right. Danny Williams is being prayed for right now by family. He's very nervous, obviously. He's in a big room. This time, hundreds of TV cameras reportedly showed up. They haven't swung the camera around, but I was told about reporters there, David Knight on the ground. In Washington, D.C., the reported illegitimate son of Bill Clinton being prayed for right now at the National Press Club, 6 days out from the election. We'll get into WikiLeaks and the latest developments there in a moment and the latest on election fraud. But right now, let's go to the live press conference that Infowars.com is covering. There's also a link to it on DrudgeReport.com.
Together in the spirit of unity. God bless you. Thank you. Thank
you. Okay, thank you so much. Dr. Lancaster Short, now we're going to hear from, Danny's going to give some remarks, and then we will open the floor for some question and answer. Okay, Danny?
Hello.
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 Hello. My name is Danny Williams. As you can see, I'm the black son of former President Bill Clinton and the stepson of Hillary Clinton. I am happy to be here in Washington, D.C. at the National Press Club today. Thank you all for joining me here today. I really appreciate it. I have struggled all my life to get the acknowledgement of my father and stepmother because, like any child, I want to know my dad and I want him to know me. At this time, I am reaching out to Ms. Lewinsky, Monica Lewinsky, with a personal letter to request her help. I have sent the letter today. It tells Monica my story and explains why I need her help. This is the letter. A copy of this letter is available to you all today.
Right.
I'm asking that Ms. Lewinsky allow me to borrow her blue dress in order to obtain a DNA sample of my father's, former President Bill Clinton, in order to finally prove that he is my father. Ms. Lewinsky, when I was a toddler, my mom went to prison, and my aunt, Lucille Bolton, took over guardianship of me. My aunt tried to reach out to my father and stepmother. I was at the age of 5. My aunt Lucille took me to the Arkansas Governor Mansion. She was trying to get my father, former President Bill Clinton, to accept me. She told Hillary, this is your son. He has a black son out here. But Hillary slammed the door in their face. And we were ran off the ground by security guards. After that, we did receive money every month, $701 bills and Christmas presents, all the way up until 1993. The presents was delivered by Arkansas state troopers. So I feel like my father Bill Clinton was trying to be a part of my life. Right. Former Arkansas State Trooper Larry Patterson has recently confirmed that he is the one who delivered the Christmas present. However, all of this ended when my father became president in 93. At the time, the state of Arkansas took custody of me and my three little brothers and sisters. I grew up in foster homes, often going to bed hungry at night. I ended up dropping out of school, and today I work construction. I dropped out of school to take care of my baby sisters and brothers. I always felt bad about my father not wanting to be in my life. Was it because I was black? Was there something wrong with me? It's not fair. It has been hurtful that he doesn't want to acknowledge me. I am his only son in this world. He's my only dad. Recently, I have been telling my kids that their grandfather was the president of the United States. That amazed them. They're like, no, is that for real? I tell them, yes, it is. He is my father, and I will make sure you'll be able to meet him one day. But today I'm here to ask Ms. Lewinsky. I have attorneys who are willing to go to court in a paternity suit. It takes much time and money. I am requesting that you help me in this process quickly by letting me borrow your blue dress. I mean, it means the world to me and my kids.
Mm-hmm.
I have to know. I have to know, who am I? And maybe my father and stepmother, Hillary, will accept me one day. The DNA test, I have to get a DNA test to prove I am their son once and for all. Mr. Lewinsky, please help me.
Help him.
I also want to take this opportunity to appeal to my stepmother, Hillary Clinton. She has the power to have Bill Clinton provide a DNA sample. I heard Hillary say she spent her life helping children. She spent her life helping children.
She says.
I mean, Black Lives Matter to her.
Yes.
If Black Lives truly matter to her, why not mine?
Yes.
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 Why don't you care about me? Hillary, are you embarrassed about me? Hillary, are you ashamed of me? I am black. I am real. Hillary, please don't deny my existence. You are my stepmother. Chelsea is my sister. Bill Clinton is my father. Please just step up at this time and treat me like an equal member of your family.
This is Danny Williams, National Press Club.
It takes a village to raise a kid. I just want her to accept me in her village today.
Yes.
Bill Clinton's reported son asking for a paternity test via the semen on the blue dress of Monica Lewinsky.
Okay. Thank you so much, Danny. I'm going to open the floor to some questions.
Now Joe Gilbert's going to take questions. This should get interesting. See if David or whoever can pan the camera to see the crowd.
Yes,
he's doing a good job.
Johnny Rice, Christian minister, and thank you, Danny, for your boldness
to share your story
for Alex Jones Media, sharing it, and Mr. Joel. So I just want to share with you, I'm also illegitimate.
Nobody's illegitimate.
But guess what? Jesus Christ, we're all legitimate under him. He's my father. He's my mother.
Amen.
Okay, thank you.
And just thank you so much. But Joel, I want to ask you a question.
Okay.
Does this raise the question, with Hillary and her big support of Planned Parenthood, Margaret Sanger, you know, the eugenics, because according to them, I should, you know, maybe not.
Well, I'll just make a quick comment. This is more about Danny, but just quick comment is we know that the progressives and Democrats have been putting Planned Parenthood clinics mostly in black neighborhoods for many, many years.
That's right.
And people will take that into consideration about...
this is the Great Awakening, folks. You're seeing it happen.
Question, please. Next question. Yes, sir.
Danny, a lot of critics are saying, I mean, that this is a whole stunt. I know you've negated that, but why now in terms of... timeliness, like why are you bringing this now?
I've been trying forever. Now's the time to get the attention.
The thing is, now I've been researching my whole life. At 92, I was a kid. Now I'm grown with kids of my own. And.
Okay, we just lost our video feed there. We'll see how fast that comes back up with our feed of the press conference. I heard like an alarm or something go off. And then the feed cut. We'll try to reconnect and see how that works. It's reconnected. Let's go ahead and put that feed back up. Again, there's feeds on Infowars.com. DrudgeReport.com has on the left-hand side as well, in case one of the feeds goes down. Live video interrupted. Broadcast has been paused. Okay, so we will continue to follow that as it unfolds. But regardless, we're taping it live there, so you'll be able to see what happens and what unfolds. As that develops. Infowars.com. Again, we have the latest article. Is WikiLeaks about to release Hillary's 33,000 deleted emails? Kim.com. Clinton in serious trouble with new info about leak. Internet security expert Kim.com says Hillary Clinton is in serious trouble with new information set to leak that some speculate could be a WikiLeaks release of Hillary Clinton's 33,000 deleted emails. There's unprecedented material yet to come. Clinton is in serious trouble. The mega uploader founder tweeted last night, there's unpublished material yet to come. By the way, we had him set up a few weeks ago, and I didn't know he wanted to be interviewed by me. So it was by someone else, so he dropped out and didn't do the interview. I'm going to get Kim.com back on. I'll write an interview him anytime he wants. This guy has gone through living hell. Never been a U.S. citizen. Doesn't have businesses here. He's had helicopters raid his house in New Zealand when his kids are there, just trying to kidnap him. I mean, it's just crazy. And he is tied into all the folks at WikiLeaks, obviously. Kim.com's promise is worthy of attention, given that his longstanding relationship with WikiLeaks and Julian Assange. Their interview with Bloomberg in May of 2015.com, real name Kim Schmitz, acknowledged, "I love to talk to them." He also predicted that Julian Assange would be Hillary's worst nightmare in 2016 because he has access to information. A forecast of things to come. And here's a clip of him talking about that.
You tweeted that you were going to be Hillary's worst nightmare in 2016. How so?
Well, I have to say it's probably more Julian. But I'm aware of some of the things that are going to be roadblocks for her. So, you know, if I can... provide some transparency with these people and make them part of what the Internet Party stands for, then, you know, I will be happy to do that.
You're saying Julian Assange is going to be Hillary's worst nightmare in 2016?
I think so, yeah. So...
Well, he has access to information.
What information?
I don't know the specifics.
Why Hillary in particular?
Well, Hillary hates Julian. She is just an adversary of, I think, Internet freedom. And
she signed your extradition request.
Yeah.
She's an adversary. What's the Bible call the devil? The adversary. She is an adversary of Internet freedom, which means freedom. And just pulling back and looking at what's in these emails, again, smoking gun after smoking gun, open and shut cases, her entire crew, Podesta, her, all should be going to prison. Espionage. It's come out now that he didn't get rid of his stocks with the Russians and just hid them with his family. I mean, the FBI thinks there's new info in the Wiener emails. Okay, maybe you have it all to reopen it. You had enough to convict her 100 times before. Now it's thousands of times. Every day there's hundreds of new emails with just total criminality, rigging everything, giving CNN the questions, giving Hillary the questions. Total control, hating the general public, wanting to make us poor, wanting to keep us stupid. I mean, they say things like this. Keep us dumb. Keep us in the dark. Now, the biggest news we've broken in a long time happened yesterday. And this is a short video that I'm going to post on Infowars.com the next hour. And I would direct everyone to share it with everyone you know, because it's a condensed version of what Bev Harris broke down yesterday. And it's extremely pertinent information. The article is How America's Elections Are Hacked, Missing Link Discovered. That's still linked in the center of DrudgeReport.com. I'm going to have it updated with our latest video. Is that it? They've actually updated. Is that the 4 minute? Go ahead and click on that then, since you hovered over it. How long is that video? Click the top link. Yeah, no, that's a longer version. But that's an 11-minute boil down from the hour interview, which is very powerful. But we've got an even shorter one that I want to push because the general public, not our listeners, the general public that we're reaching with these videos will not watch something longer than 4 minutes if we're lucky. And this is their whole future. They're being robbed, but they're in a trance. We've got to get them out of the trance. So we're going to upload this video and add it to that article and also post it by itself. I don't know how you describe this video. Bev Harris is the top expert. She says it's the biggest thing she ever discovered. It's going in machines all over the country, different vendors, different companies, and it's designed openly where you pre-program the votes and then it shaves them. I mean, there's no getting around it. And then she has people on video running from her, elections officials with computers out back doors when she shows up, you know, with people in court orders to get a copy of it. I mean, this is how you take over society, folks. You put this in, you and yours can stay in power forever and do whatever you want. Travis County doesn't have real elections, ladies and gentlemen. It's been staged for 30 years to a great extent. And I've proven the election fraud. It's been certified at the state level, but nothing was done. I mean, I have experienced it myself. I've seen it with my eyeballs at the central tabulation centers where they fix the numbers. Well, now they have super easy algorithms, one little program they put in, 1 minute download or quicker, and it works 100% of the time. Proven. And that's what's going on. So let's go ahead and go to this report from Bev Harris. This is the biggest news of the election season because all of it's important. The corruption, the rigging, the lying, the fake polls, Google rigging things for Hillary. All of it. We do have the press conference back now, don't we? We're going to go back to the press conference. I'm going to skip this break. We'll air a few more minutes of this because it looks heated. And then we're going to get to the Bev Harris piece. But I'm telling you, folks, I know you're awake. You're involved. You know about vote flipping. This is beyond that. Okay? This is the big kahuna. This is the big enchilada. Now let's go to Danny Williams.
My whole life. Mm-hmm.
And let's be real. It's hard for blacks to find money to push and fund their cause. And we all in this room know it.
They know that.
And then as a kid, people looked at me like I was a big liar. I told people he was my father. So.
Danny, can you comment?
Hold on, one at a time. His family's got some good looking ladies in it.
Danny,
see what old Bill is about.
If I was a major figure of public importance.
Yes, sir.
And someone was running around claiming to be my son.
Yes, sir.
And I knew he wasn't. And I had
Hillary, Bill Clinton, as indicted by their daughter.
Hold a news conference. I would hire a lawyer.
They got that.
I would have them send you a letter.
That's right.
And say cease and desist. You're defaming me. You're libeling me. Has any lawyer or anybody representing Bill Clinton ever told you stop it? You're not his son.
No. They actually kicked out my YouTube the other day. They actually tried to hush me. So, no.
Or is it the case then that they're depending on the press, like the Washington Post back here, and Dana Milbank, to write a story making fun of you and questioning Joel Gilbert? They don't want to report the evidence, the truth. They're depending on the press.
That's Cliff Kincaid, the former CNN host of Crossfire.
Can you elaborate on the YouTube?
Yeah.
Can you elaborate on what happened with YouTube? Because it's not just the established press, but it's also the new social media that's censoring your message,
basically,
right?
Basically, they say that we violated the terms of YouTube, and you've seen the video yesterday. There's no disrespect, no foul language. There's no way we violated it.
That's right.
And they kicked it out of YouTube. So we had to, you know.
And how many views did you have at that point?
We had over 20 million views.
Mm.
So.
Yeah, the
The YouTube account was permanently deleted, and only because InfoWars, I think WorldNet Daily, covered it. A day later, miraculously, they wrote a note and said, we have reviewed your account and have decided you did not violate the terms of service and restored it. So there was an attempt to silence Danny again, but we're here today to make sure that doesn't happen.
There was even an attempt to undermine this meeting by directing the press to go to the Willard Hotel. Yeah. They suppressed us sending this to...
We saw that happen in Nevada as well.
Yes, every dirty trick when they got CIA on the ground, folks.
Representing John Cheeks, who's running for city council at large, openly for reparations for black people. This feeds into why we need relief. Danny, could you tell us what can the political...
Well, Donald Trump wants to cut your taxes, just especially for black communities, which I'm fine with. But reparations,
support you,
how about you just, the government gets off your back?
What can they do at this time that would help his cause?
I mean, basically, Hillary, I said it once before, Hillary has the power. Tell them to step forward. I mean, I asked for this under the table before I was even going to file for this. So we was simply asking for...
I interviewed his aunt 20 years ago.
They haven't stepped up, so now, I mean, we have no choice but to go to the courts.
Danny, if you can't get...
Hold on. What's your name?
Freddie Allen from the NBA.
Okay, go ahead.
If you can't get the dress, what's your next step?
Continue with the paternity suit. I mean, when I started this 2 years ago, I set my goals and I go day by day.
Yeah, he started contacting us. Contacting Biggs, and I'll be quite frank with you. I mean, I knew he was probably the son, but I was just like, what did people do? I kind of dropped the ball on it. The reason I bring that up is Media Matters, and people say we're all staging this and we're like behind it. I forgot there was a press conference. I knew they were talking about it a few weeks ago. It's like Danny talking to us on Facebook. And then I get to see the media. Oh, it's this big stage thing. Meanwhile, they're the ones staging everything.
Next question. Anybody have a question? Yes, I love you.
I'm glad Gilbert picked up the torch. He's helping out.
Media and news outlets offered to have you come on and share your story.
Well, we're happy to have right behind you CBS and Fox News. Let's give them a hand for showing up.
Yeah, that's Millie Weaver right there. Infowars.com reporter just asked the question.
I think we even have the TASS news agency from Russia represented. So we got quite a mix. In terms of the mainstream type of folks, they have really avoided it. I think we saw a couple of clips on CNN where black activists threw out the name of Danny Williams, also the chairman of the Utah State Republican Party, and Carol Costello freaked out and cut him off. And that typically is their reaction. They're scared to death, and they don't want...
Yeah, I was watching Williams' body language earlier. It's Bill Clinton's son, man. The way his hands are moving, the face, the little mannerisms.
1998, 99, this is starting to come...
That's Bill Clinton's son. I mean, it's obvious.
Dad's law, which made it, change it from a misdemeanor to a felony if you cross state lines to try to avoid paternity. He said at the time that it's something we needed to do for the health and the education of our children and the future of our nation. Can you respond to that hypocrisy?
Yes, sir, I've done my research on that, and to hear him stand up there and make that speech during that time, it was hurting because, like, he made a deadbeat dead law, and he's a deadbeat dead. Then he wanted to give men's feelings. You know, once they put on child support, if they leave the state, it's a felony charge.
There's the big headline.
I mean,
Bill Clinton's son, he passed a deadbeat dad law, and he's a deadbeat dad. We need to tweet that. Danny Williams. Bill Clinton passed a deadbeat dad law when he's a deadbeat dad.
Question. Yes, sir.
Were there any major donors for your GoFundMe? I know you raised quite a bit of money. And how much money exactly have you raised? And have you received any donations from any political parties?
Irrelevant. Right now, we had to take a little money out to get here, me and my friend Steven. So I think it was, $2,800? I mean, we're not getting much money, but we're getting money.
Yeah.
People support me.
He helped him with hotel and plane tickets. Right. I'm here, man. How's he supposed to get here? They just turn it all around. We have a guest. We flew here as well.
Just getting by really week to week is what
coming in later. That Hillary covered up the physical attack on.
I just want to say, kind of to sum this up, the thing is that Bill Clinton's extramarital affairs are no secret to any of us in this nation. We all know it. I think, but there are so many people who admire him and still hold him up in the midst of all this going on in this election season. There are a lot of people who really think that he is a decent person. So I'm saying, if we think in terms of that, I'm actually asking Bill Clinton, as a decent man, as a good person, to the very core, if you really are that person.
Actually, don't give him ideas. If he recognized Danny, that could help Hillary.
For asking, do the right thing.
Right.
Hugged him and everything. And said, I wasn't sure. Oh, we did the test. You're my son. That would make him look great. But they're too disconnected. Let's go back to her.
With not coming forward, it's looking more and more like you are. And if that's the case, then do the right thing. You know, we always tell our young men in this country, if their girlfriend gets pregnant, to stand up, to man up, to be a man.
Man up.
So I'm asking
be a man, Bill Clinton.
President Clinton, with all due respect, man up.
All
right, this is powerful. We're going to have another interview with him, exclusive, right after this ends. It'll go out live. Just tell Dan to do it as a live Facebook mentions, but also HD recorded. And then we've got a bunch of big guests coming up. Stay with us. Talk radio was the original internet because you could call in to it. It was uncensored to a great extent. It was long form. It was hard to have teleprompter heads in there. And it started getting really popular about the 70s, so they passed laws to not let there be political views, which, of course, it was all just liberal garbage. Then by the late 80s, they got rid of the Fairness Doctrine. You saw the return of talk radio fusing with the internet right as it was being popularized. It was born, obviously, in the 60s. And so this format of talk radio / film / live feeds fusing with the internet is the future. And we've been doing it I've been doing this style show for at least 15, 16 years. We were the first. I'm not bragging. We did it through necessity just to reach people. I was a radio host who wanted to do internet TV. We've done it. And I'm very honored to be here. History's happening. And very few people actually get what's happening in the media. That it's not about your ABC, your NBC, your Fox. It's about you put out your analysis. You link to other people. You pick up this feed. You pick up that feed. You dip into lots of different things and get different perspectives and get outside the bubble. Google wants to make it all about they keep you in your little plantation, your little niche, and they feed you what you think you want and then control you. And they've got all these algorithms out saying they're giving it. It's come out in the WikiLeaks to Obama, and they're targeting the undecided, 10 million voters to turn them for Hillary. Well, those are the undecided that don't just accept the Google results. They're hoping you just accept whatever you're given instead of looking at Google, looking at Yahoo, looking at AP, looking at Drudge, looking at WorldNet Daily, looking at InfoWars, looking at your email feed, looking at what people are sending you on Facebook, looking at what's on Twitter, reading what's in the local paper, shoot a video off local PBS of something happening, and then talk about it yourself. That's how you add new content that the globalists don't centralize. They just put out their big centralized reports, and then they just hope that we debate that little area instead of. I never did this on purpose. I would take some police state story or some corruption story, and I would talk about it on radio and make it national. Back when even most talk show hosts would just cover national stuff, very rarely would they cover something somewhere that happened. And I early on was like, why don't people do this? But I noticed Drudge was doing it. Drudge was starting, dominating by the time I got on air in like 95, 96. And I just remember like, oh, yeah, there's local stories and things. This is interesting. So it's kind of a breaking up the monopoly of who sets the table and who sets the menu. And I absolutely love it. I mean, I'm looking at a press conference here with this crying, member of his family up here praying with Danny Williams. This guy's totally real. That was such veritas. It was so powerful. I feel so good being part of that. And we're putting in a live Trump feed, and we're getting ready to have guests on, and it's just amazing. Now, remember, listeners, this is the big fusion broadcast. If you want to see this stuff by itself, it's on InfoWars.com. It's on DrudgeReport.com. Because I can't tell you how many people tune in and want to hear the press conference. I'm like, no, this is the show. This is radio. We have breaks. It's a format. I've got to follow it. But we've got the totally free internet for you right now. So it's like channels. We're like a network. So the press conference just broke up. So we've got a lot unfolding there. If David wants to go get with Danny in 10, 15 minutes and do a private interview as they've offered, we could pop in with that as well. We have Kathy Shelton joining us, who is one of Hillary Clinton's victims. And I guess we've got the Hillary famous clips and stuff ready of her laughing about it. But I'm going to let her and her lawyer come in here and get into all this. She's a little teenage girl, 12 years old, 13 years old. And I've forgotten more about the Clintons than most people know. I mean, seriously, I'm just so sick of them. I try to like put it out of my mind sometimes. But Hillary's a monster. And this just shows her whole history and what she's been involved in and what she does. It takes somebody really evil, even with our corrupt government and our corrupt agencies, and there are problems, obviously, to totally turn against her. The whole world's against her because they understand she's uber bad. Uber bad. Now, we're going to come back from break and play the Bev Harris crystallized, condensed interview on the biggest election fraud news ever, and then have our guest in studio. I'm Alex Jones, InfoWars.com.
The door to the tabulating room has been closed, and the two Presley brothers are in there without any observers whatsoever, and that is not okay. I'm not kidding people. They're switching out computers. They just took one in, and now they're taking another one out.
I wonder why would a PC glass...
All right, hold on. They're taking computers out of the building. The guy with the PC is now... This is unbelievable.
Bev Harris, I've been on air 21 years. I've interviewed you probably 30 times over the years. I've never been this blown away watching the video. It's on screen right now for radio listeners. They can go to InfoWars.com. It's in the article, How America's Elections Are Being Hacked, Missing Link Discovered. This is just so bombshell. Or just go to blackboxvoting.org. Fraction Magic is the top story there on the left. Get this video from YouTube and make it go super viral. Where should we begin?
Well, you know, we've found some new information, and I think it's the missing piece that we didn't have before. A gentleman by the name of Benny Smith out of Memphis, Tennessee, discovered what I would characterize as a master key, which essentially lets one person control with invisibly and with remarkable precision down to the precinct level and down to the type of voting, early voting and so forth, or whatever type they want. Many different locations at once, multiple counties and multiple states. It has actually been in the system since it's put in the system in 2001, but it became into wide use in 2006. But it kind of took someone with a special set of skills to know what to look for. He didn't just do like most of the people did, where he says, "Well, let me just look at the program and see what I think." He is a guy who has some background in political forecasting and so forth. And he knew what would be needed. He kind of went, let me design what I think would be needed in order to succeed with widespread election fraud. And after he did that, he went, now let me see if the pieces that I know are necessary are built into the system. They should not be. And he was amazed when he found, after looking at the files, that the pieces were built in to commit very large-scale fraud using a feature that had been very little known before. And so there's this one central computer, which at the end of the day, all the votes come to it. That's where you take it. You don't run around to 5,000 different things in precincts. You wait till the votes come to you, and then you have your way with them. And it's very, very precise. It's invisible, and there's absolutely, it doesn't matter whether the system's on the internet or not. None of the stuff that they say is a protection matters at all. You have your way with them. Then you, once you control the votes in whatever way you want, for whatever target you want, you know, the election is done. Now, there is something new that can be done, and this is really exciting because it's kind of scaring the pants off of them, actually. And at the very end of the video, I make sort of a cryptic reference to it, but we didn't realize that more than half of the voting machines in the country now take a picture of every ballot. Even the touchscreen machines that supposedly have no paper are keeping an image of every ballot. But now think about this. You run a paper ballot through, and it takes a picture of it, and that's just an electronic file, right? That's, you should be able to get that under public records request, right? It's just a file, and you ought to be able to get all those images. In fact, there was one county in California that was putting all those on the web. Why not? When they put them all on the web, guess what happened? Everybody looked and found out there was a whole precinct that never got counted at all by the machine.
Wow.
Essentially, these ballot images are and must be public record, and people must ask for them. Now, let me tell you what happened when a gentleman from Arizona asked for them. He said, okay, I want under my freedom of information rights, I want all your ballot images. Basically, you can do your own recount that way, right? And we did find that they do not succumb to the fraction magic attack. Well, when he asked for them, they said, we destroy them every day.
Bev, I know you never like it, but let me tell you something. I interviewed the other vote fraud experts that were before you, the Collier brothers and others, and they died, and their daughter, she's great, and other folks. I'm just saying, you are so dynamic. You've done, with your crew and the folks, 10 times what anybody else ever did. So that's why I single you out, because you're amazing, and you're such a treasure. All right, that's a boil down of the exclusive Bev Harris breaking news yesterday. It's so huge. Only Drudge Report has picked it up. And a few other liberty-based outlets. It's gotten millions and millions of readers and viewers. But you'd think national news that has had her with HBO documentaries, and she's been all over CNN, Fox, she's been everywhere, as the consummate expert, she discovers the biggest news of her 20-year research into this. She was a former top federal fraud investigator before that, and there's been no coverage so far. Maybe since I got on air there has been. We should Google that or search engine that. But that is such a big video. That's the boil down of the hour interview. We're going to be posting that in the next hour or so to Infowars.com. Now, joining us for the next 45 minutes in studio, we're also going to do some taped interviews with us for the nightly news, are Kathy Shelton and Candace Jackson. And Candace Jackson is a graduate of honors from Stanford University, a lawyer. I'm not going to get into her whole background, but she's just a great lady. They're not seeking anything right now from Bill Clinton. They're not out to even get anybody here. They're not out to get Hillary Clinton. They're just talking about the reality of what happened to her when she was a 12-year-old girl so long ago when Hillary Clinton was a young lawyer. And so they're just seeking for the public to be aware of this. Now, we've played the tapes. We'll play them later. I know it's hard for Kathy to listen to of Hillary making jokes about the man that reportedly who she got off, but raped her when she was 12 years old, and she was in a coma for days, and that's not disputed. And Hillary laughs that she knew he was guilty, but he took a lie detector and passed it, so that destroyed her confidence in lie detectors. It just shows the true mindset, the predatory nature of what we're dealing with. TheirLivesFoundation.net, TheirLivesFoundation.net, and again, Candace Jackson is her lawyer, just on her own dime, here doing this because she cares about women's issues and justice. Kathy and Candace, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
So much to cover, so much to talk about. I'm going to skip this break so we have more time because I got to you late playing those clips. Why are you here first? For TV viewers and radio listeners, I think I kind of described what you talked about on your foundation site, what I've heard you say. I know you were at the debates. Mr. Trump had you there. Why are you speaking out now? Because your case is documented. It's a fact what happened to you. Why are you speaking out?
Because Hillary's on tape laughing, saying that she knows that they're guilty, and has made some other remarks down the line. And I'm standing up for what's right for me because I know it happened. And she's trying to make me look like a liar and that I asked for it and all that. And
by the way, we should pull up a photo of you when you were 12. That's online. People can also go to theirlivesfoundation.net. We can put that website on screen for people so we can personalize this. You were a little girl. I have a 12-year-old daughter. I have an 8-year-old daughter. And, before I had daughters and children, I would get upset hearing about abuse of women and children. But now, I'm going to be honest, it makes me just start feeling very violent whenever I think about people abusing little girls, especially.
And I think what can't be underestimated is you take a case like this and the level of violence. This was, rape is always a horrible crime. This was no ordinary rape. He beat and almost murdered this little girl so badly. She was in a coma for 5 days. So you top that off with there being absolutely zero justice for the victim, Kathy, in this case. And that's makes it a double tragedy. And that was deliberately designed and pulled off by Hillary Clinton.
Again, Candace Jackson, tell folks why you've gotten involved and then just encapsulate the case. And we'll get into the personal things that you know, Kathy's gone through. But Candace, looking at this, I mean, what makes you a busy person running your own law firm, very successful, all these big letters to your name, CandaceJackson.com? What makes you spend so much time and energy on this and then break down the nuts and bolts of the case?
Well, you know, I have, over the years, writing about it, speaking about it, gotten to know some of the women who have accused Bill Clinton of sexual abuse very well. And I realized this year that Kathy's story is one that it's so different, it's so unique. It really does represent the epitome of the type of corruption that Hillary Clinton practices. It has nothing to do with her husband, Bill Clinton. It has everything to do with her choices, Hillary's own choices, and decisions to bend and break rules, ignore protocol and procedures, cheat the system, rig the system to get an outcome that she wants.
And by the way, we now learn about Tim Kaine. He would cry when horrible rapists and killers and people, he was unable to get them off. And he said he enjoyed it. And there's these videos of him acting really weird. It's like some type of celebration. It's like, who are these people?
Well, you look at Hillary Clinton's career, and it baffles me so much that she has been allowed, mostly by our mainstream press and to the shame of her own party, to somehow be held up as some kind of champion for women and fighter for justice for children through 40 years of her career, when time after time she's chosen the side of rapists just to make herself look good, win this case, put into practice principles of liberal philosophy with regard to criminal policy. Let's not lock them up. It's not really the criminal's fault. Let's get him back out on the street.
I'll tell you what, counselor, then, for TV viewers, there's camera too. I mean, lay out, this is a fact. I mean, lay out what happened in this case to people. And to Kathy, you know, right over there, you know, staring at folks in TV land, anytime you want to jump in and talk to Hillary Clinton, you know, talk to the media, because they can't deny your case. I mean, it's so powerful. And they're trying to take stuff with Trump and blow it out of proportion. Fine. If they ever got in trouble, then we could talk about Trump with something 50 times less, 100 times less. It's the hypocrisy. So, counselor, you know, talking to the viewers out there.
The hypocrisy is astounding. You've got somebody out there who claims to be an early feminist, a fighter and defender and champion for women and children. That's her main pitch for herself is, I'm a woman. Vote for me to put the first woman in office. I've spent my life defending children. And here's what she did in this case. Her defenders will say she was court appointed. She had no choice. She had to accept this case, and then an attorney has to defend her client. Wrong. Hillary Clinton has been lying about this case her entire career. In her autobiography, she lies about how and why she accepted this case. In the audio taped interviews that exist when she chooses to talk about this case to a journalist, she's lying. She was not a public defender. She was not required by any judge to accept this appointment. She knew that the victim in this case was a sixth grade rape victim. She chose to take the side of the rapist, most likely because she, the judge, and the judge's barely law school graduate son were all supporters and donors of Bill Clinton for Congress at the time. They all shared a liberal philosophy about programs like work release for criminals, which Hillary and the judge released this criminal for work after reducing bail in this case from $50,000 to just $2,500. And then Hillary Clinton went on to use the most vicious blame the victim tactics that I have ever seen in a case, much less put forward by some kind of feminist.
I was about to say, studying this, it's one thing if you're a defense lawyer and you give people a good show and you give them a fair shake, even if you know they're guilty. She, with glee and every dirty trick and pouring it on, stuff that I think, I'm not a constitutional lawyer like you, but I've studied it, really, you know, could get somebody disbarred in a lot of counties.
Oh, well, here's the types of tactics that she chose to use in this case. She made up lies wholesale about Kathy and her family. She said that Kathy was fantasizing about older men.
I mean, before we go there, why don't you recap what happened? I mean, I know it's hard for Kathy to talk about, but maybe you should. Kathy, do you want to tell folks, just you know, look at the camera over there and tell folks what happened to you?
I was riding my bicycle, or going a couple blocks riding my bicycle over to church, and my mother really didn't want me to, but she let me and said after church she'd pick me up in the bicycle. I talked her into it because it was still daylight, because she always worried about me, but it was like a couple blocks away. On the way over there, this truck stopped. Two men got out of it and started coming towards me, and it scared me really bad. And they told me I was going with them, and I said, no, I'm not. I tried to get away, but I couldn't. They jerked me off my bicycle. They put me in the truck. They started ripping my clothes off of me. I was screaming and crying, trying to holler for help. And it was like no one heard me. We go out on a road somewhere, just this plum fields. I don't remember what road it is today. I remember all the fields. And they were beating me, and they raped me. And he was saying he knew I liked it, except in a more terribly manner than that. I was left out on the ground, barely conscious. Sometimes at one time I was unconscious. I crawled to a porch out of nowhere. I don't know where the house was or how I made it there, but they thought they had killed me, and they were coming back for me. And the lady at the porch, I crawled at, turned her porch light on, and it scared them back off. And she got their tag number, and that's how they caught them today. And
Wow, a girl beat in a field, and reportedly you were in a coma for, what, 5 days?
Yes, I woke up in the hospital 5 days later out of a coma and was told that I couldn't, 99% chance I couldn't have kids, and I had several stitches down in my private area.
Now, I've read some about this, but correct me if I'm wrong. These were like kind of the cool good old boys or something, so I guess they kind of got special treatment, and then they must have been crazy good old boys to think you could rape a little girl out in the middle of a field and then get your tags, you know, documented and still not basically fry for it.
You know, to be honest, there's still a lot of unanswered questions and a lot unknown about the background of this case. We've been working very hard at Their Lives Foundation as a pure act of love to try to uncover facts around this case. It's not easy to do. Not surprisingly, in a case like this that the Clintons would prefer remain buried and hidden, lots of records have disappeared. This is now 41 years ago. The suspect, who was 41 years old at the time, died in 1992. I've spoken to family members of him. There's a lot of vagueness about what his life was like, what he went on to do, et cetera. So there's a lot of information missing about this case, and that's part of why we are digging hard to pull together the true facts.
Sure. Well, a lot of the left has made a big deal about rape culture, and God, I know it goes on, but then they project it onto, like, you know, stuff where it's very vague, and maybe she, you know, had too much to drink and she didn't know. Okay, fine, whatever. That's bad. Don't do it. But when people are beating and raping 12-year-old girls and ripping their bodies open and putting them in comas, I have daughters. Seriously, it makes me so angry. I don't usually shoot my mouth off about, you know, being aggressive, but if this, I just can't see how Hillary and the judge and the town and everybody just didn't care. I mean, they were just throwing you away.
Yes, sir, they was. And she is now today is telling stories like it was a family member. And I said they can check my family history. He's not no family member. Says they asked me to get in the truck, offered me a Coke to get in, and that is not true. I've heard several different stories now. There's just all kinds of stories going around that's not true.
Well, we all know how it works in Arkansas and some areas of Texas. Money gets paid and people get off.
Sure, and I think that there was a legitimate divide. Not every single person involved with this case was happy and pleased about the fact that a violent criminal in their community went free. But people like the judge and the judge's son and even the prosecutor to some extent were on the Democrat-liberal side of things philosophically and truly believe that rehabilitation should trump punishment. And maybe it's not criminals' fault that they act this way.
And sure, so again, we have the audio of Hillary. We've played it many times. We'll probably play it when we come back, admitting she knew he was guilty. She couldn't believe it, that he passed a lie detector, which destroyed her faith in lie detectors, then laughs about it. And again, it's not just once. She got kicked off the Watergate committee for falsifying stuff. Her whole life is like doing evil things when doing good would have been better for her.
You would think so. Why would she stand up and try to get this rapist off when she could have joined the side of the victim and spoken up like some early Gloria Allred on the side of the victim? But no, she chooses the side of the rapist every time.
And now her and Michelle want to get up and be all breathless about Donald Trump. And oh, they're so scared. And so we'll be right back with both of our guests. I'm Alex Jones, InfoWars.com. Stay with us. I'm Alex Jones, your host. We're now T-minus 6 days out from the most historic election in U.S. history. Every corrupt, evil regime, from the communist Chinese, the biggest mass murderers in history, the biggest abusers of women in history, the Saudi Arabians, and all the big banks and the major media and the think tanks and the lobbyists are lined up against Donald Trump. They came out with this outrageous claim that no one would run with for months. I mean, we'd even seen it floating around, that they had tracked some server. They could easily, if they were really smart, get into one of his hundreds of hotels and things and actually make a link and create a false flag. But they don't even do that. They go, oh, we have chatter between a Russian server and Trump. Even the New York Times said it's total bull. Turned out, it came out in the New York Times today, Drudge had the big headline, that they have been inside investigating Trump, the FBI has, with warrants, everything, digging. It's why he kept saying, I'm under an audit right now, I can't tell you. See, Trump didn't tell you they edited the Billy Bush tape. It was totally, you could hear it, but now it's going to come out after the whole deal. Because he knows the public will think he's looking like a wimp if he, you know, sits there and doesn't just apologize. And I'm saying what he did was perfect. Billy Bush goes, actually, I goaded him for an hour to tell me sex stories, and then we edited it. I mean, that's what they got. But the point is that Hillary's the one with the secret server to the Russians. Podesta's the one. Everything they do, they then accuse us of. They accuse me of being a Russian agent. I think I know babushka means a baby. I think goulash means like that good, like soup, you know, like hash meat. I mean, I don't know anything about Russians. I want to go to Russia someday. I hear it's really neat to see. It's historical. I've read history books about it. But I mean, it's just like I'm sitting here defending the Republic, just trying to sustain our country and get some tax cuts so we can get our economy going. And I mean, called a Russian agent. America is rejecting all of this big time. And I've never gotten into a campaign like this because it was usually, you know, McCain, Obama, you know. Now, this is so clear. This is such an incredible time to be alive just to repudiate the entire system. Does it mean we're going to be on some bed of roses after that? Absolutely not. We're going back to our guests, a constitutional lawyer, Candace Jackson, and, of course, Kathy Shelton, their lives. Foundation.net, with all she's gone through, confirmed, raped at 12 years old, Hillary Clinton admitting in tapes, we're going to play some of it, that she knew that her client was guilty, but didn't care because he was all part of this Politico system. Before we go any further, though, and then Leanne's going to be popping in, I asked her to come on. Leanne is so humble as a reporter. She's an expert on this case, really followed it, is doing a piece on the Nightly News. I said, well, you come on, Leanne, talk about this. And she's like, I don't want to barge in and everything. So I said, Leanne, it's the media. You're going on air. Everybody loves Leanne. So she's coming on to talk to us here in just a moment, bring up some of her points. But we have the final 24 hours to save 30 to 40% off on super high quality, produced here in America, in Utah, storable foods. 24 hours left. Normally, we have a 10% discount, private labeling, My Patriot Supply. It's the exact same food. We sell their whole catalog right next to it at InfoWarsStore.com. But we can do this occasionally under our contract, 30 to 40% off. The lowest discount is 30%, as high as 40%. Now is the time to take action. There's a reason FEMA report predicts a 395% increase in food prices that could trigger mass unrest. Look at all the stuff the globalists are doing. They want us dependent. We should be independent. We don't know exactly what's coming, but we can start getting ready for whatever may happen. 34% off InfoWarsStore.com. That's InfoWarsSelect. InfoWarsSelect.com takes you right to the subpage. We have the ProPure G2 Gravity King filter, the biggest system they've got. Sits on your countertop. Amazing. Cuts all the garbage out. 30% off InfoWarsStore.com as well right now. And finally, some of our sponsors, Solutions from Science Solar Generator. I bought one from them. Now, they've upgraded it many times, 10 years ago, because it was the best, highest rated, lowest cost, expandable unit. So I wanted to start with something medium size and build out a control panel, you know, and a few panels. I bought another one last year. Actually, I had one for the office, one for home. Of their latest system, the Perfect Power Solar Generator, and it is amazing. It's expandable. It has a wind input, so you can plug wind power into it to the battery system. It even produces pure sine wave power, so you can run medical equipment or even military-grade electronics. Go to PowerGridChaos.com. That's PowerGridChaos.com. Save 70% while supplies last. That's PowerGrid. You know, talk PowerGridChaos.com. So save over 70% while supplies last. PowerGridChaos.com, and it is your purchase and support of the products, everything we do here that makes it all possible. I'm not bragging, but we've got reporters covering live Danny Williams press conferences. We've got reporters out with all the, you know, political events that are happening. We are breaking many of the major news stories every day that are game changers in the promotion of private property, the Second Amendment, justice, sovereignty, common sense, Americana, free association, classical liberalism. We're the tip of the spear. And I want to thank you, listeners, for your prayers, your support, visiting the store, spreading the word, sending our videos out, because I don't want to be a slave of the globalist. You don't want to be a slave of the globalist. We're all in this together, and our ideas, our understanding is becoming the main narrative because it's real. The military, from the highest level to the lowest, clicks with us because they know what we're saying is accurate. It's not the fantasy land that's on mainstream TV. And we're real people. We're not scripted. We didn't script this interview beforehand. We didn't script that press conference you just saw. We're just taking action, rolling our sleeves up, and doing the best job we can. So Candace Jackson, again, a lawyer, just free of charge doing this, doing a great job with Kathy Shelton, the 12-year-old, when she was a rape victim by a whole bunch of men, in a coma for 5 days, her body torn apart, theirlivesfoundation.net. We can put up images of you when you were 12 and what happened. Candace recapping this and why it's such a miscarriage of justice. And then anytime, Kathy, you want to pop in. And then we've got Leanne McAdoo, who I drug in here, because she's really hot about this case. She's angry about it, and I am too.
Well, people should be angry about this case. It is unbelievable the hypocrisy that Hillary Clinton is getting away with to have this reputation and self-promotion as a defender of women and children's rights activist, and then deliberately, voluntarily choose to take the side of a child rapist here and do not only everything within the bounds of legal ethics and law to get him off. That would be bad enough that she chose to do that and be on his side. But in order to win her case, in order to look good, in order to prove that she can win, she bent the rules. She went outside proper procedure. She violated court orders. These are things that we're uncovering by the day in this case because, hey, guess what? The mainstream media has never bothered to do it. They've taken Hillary Clinton's previous explanations and descriptions of this case at face value and never challenged a bit of it. And we are unraveling everything she has ever said about this case. And it turns out most of it's flat out lies.
What I don't get is, I've seen the old newspaper articles, I've done research on this. They admit you got raped, this happened. They admit you got grabbed in the truck and taken off. A bunch of 40-year-old men drag a 12-year-old off in a truck to a field. I say execute every one of them. You know, I mean, this is so obvious. How the hell did this happen with this Democrat judge and all this? And it's just it's like everything. She just gets away with everything.
Yeah, there is a handwritten notation in the court record. This judge has a history, we've learned and uncovered, of being pro work release for criminals, for example. Get this. He handwrote a notation in the court order, no objection to release to work during the day. So even the very little time, few months that this creep actually spent in jail, he was released during the day to go to work. You know where his workplace was? A 5-minute walk away from Kathy Shelton's house. What kind of judge agrees to do that? And what kind of defense attorney asks for that in the first place?
So whatever ended up happening, I mean, I know about the ruling and stuff.
Yeah.
But.
Well, yeah, I mean, in the end, Hillary Clinton monkeyed around with the evidence, manipulated the system enough to argue that there wasn't enough physical evidence to convict. The prosecutor rolled over in this case, by the way. There's zero evidence that he challenged Hillary Clinton's unsubstantiated stories about the physical evidence not being sufficient. So between the prosecutor rolling over, also a liberal Democrat, the judge cooperating, and Hillary Clinton having insider help to kind of make all of this happen, the end result was that before jury trial actually occurred, a plea bargain was reached. The guy pled to a much lesser charge, was sentenced to a year in jail, but it does not appear that he actually spent any time in jail.
So I probably should have said that up front. That's right. You know, he pled to a lesser charge. She, quote, got him off, but they admitted they were trying to deny it all. They'd done this. And I just can't believe the community didn't lynch these people because, again, it's just I've read the old newspaper articles. It was so cut and dry. You're grabbing a 12-year-old girl off a bike, a bunch of old men. I mean, you know, 40s old. I mean, it just makes me absolutely just imagine my daughter's out riding bikes. And I'm just sorry. I'm just telling you right now.
Even this,
you're not getting a trial. Just understand that.
Even this perpetrator's family members that I've been able to track down recently, they say, yeah, he moved around a lot. He was kind of hiding from us all. He didn't really keep in touch. So, you know,
he knew to hide out.
He knew to hide out. But I would not be surprised if the community was up in arms about this. But nobody could fight the system when it's being rigged by the defense attorney, the prosecutor, and the judge.
Unbelievable. All right, Kathy Shelton, I want to bring Leanne McAdoo in here because she's covered all the angles of this. But looking at camera four right over there, what is your message to the American people? Or if you'd like a message to Hillary Clinton, I mean, just this is your chance. Millions of people are watching. I can imagine the things happened to me when I was younger. Nothing like this. They scarred me for life. I mean, I know I've read the statistics, I've seen it, but I haven't experienced it. What it can do to somebody's whole life when they're innocent and sweet and not ever having the first experience of somebody being loving or nice to you, but just having a bunch of pigs do this to you and put you in a coma and then her protect them. What would you like to say to them?
She would do anything to get to a high spot where she wants to be. That includes lying under oath, cheating, stealing. If she was for women, she's never showed me any remorse or ever had any words to say to me since this has happened. She's always said, I'm a liar. Well, evidence of hospital records and police records and even the underwear that she sent to her crime lab, she cut out the blood evidence, and when she sent it to the crime lab, there wasn't enough to test because what she cut out was the part they needed. And
she was kicked off the Watergate thing for falsifying evidence, too.
This is a lifelong pattern for her that began at the very beginning of her career, and she's followed it up through her attitudes about setting up a private server and lying and covering up her activities that way, too. It's the same pattern.
Kathy Shelton, again, continue. Other stuff you want to tell them? What do you want to say to Hillary? Because believe me, she watches camera. I mean, what do you want to say to Hillary all these years later?
I want to say if this was her daughter that happened to, and this was her first case for her daughter, would she have got hurt? Would she have got these men off? Would she have protected them from her daughter? I don't believe she would have. I believe she would have come forward then because it would have been her daughter. But since it was somebody she didn't know at all, and I'm nothing to her, so, you know, just like any other woman or child that she says she's for, I've heard many times that the hotline she had going, when you called it, a number was supposed to call you back, and people didn't get a call back from the number.
Well, look, I mean, it's normal to have empathy as a human being. Anybody's daughter is my daughter or son. But these people don't have it. Now, they might care about their family, but only because they see it as some extension of themselves. And they're so blind. And our society seems to be run by these really handicapped individuals that are sociopathic.
Yeah, emotionally, psychologically, empathetically handicapped is a good way to put it. There just doesn't seem to be that. I think even if you had defended a guilty client in a horrific situation like this, when you choose to describe the case later like Hillary Clinton did, you would think, if you have any human decency in your heart, that you would be describing that case, starting out by saying this was terrible. This was.
But I know.
This was,
I know defense lawyers.
Instead, she laughs and she treats it lightheartedly.
By the way, we have that clip from Leanne McAdoo. Since you mentioned it, that's a great point. Here's Hillary. This is undisputed. CNN tries to say this tape's fake. Hillary admits it's real. Here's Hillary. You know, making jokes. Here it is.
Of course, he claims he did all this stuff. He took a lot of different tests. I have to apologize. She passed. What was said about it was that the prosecutors had evidence, among which was his underwear.
His what?
His underwear, which was white. Sent out of the crime lab for those efforts were formed in London. Crime lab, just a pair of underpants. Neatly cut out the part that they were going to test.
Now that's Hillary bragging to journalists she thinks are her friends that she cut the blood out of his underwear, her blood. And she's getting off on it. It's like, what frickin' planet does this demon come from? And that's the thing. In all the WikiLeaks, which confirms everything you said, they get off on bad. Where they could do better doing good, they don't. They want to do bad.
Well, she talked about having public positions versus private positions, and apparently public position is I need to be a defender of women and children. Private position?
I cut the blood off his underwear.
I'm proud of getting somebody off like this. I just want to win. I want to get ahead, win, and look good. That's who she is.
Well, I mean, most lawyers I know won't even take your case if they're good lawyers unless they think you're in the right. But then there's these weirdos that get off on representing bad people. Let's go to Leanne McAdoo. Leanne, we're going to break. I want to hold you through the rest of the interview. And I want you to do extensive interviews after because we flew them down here. And I know you're on the case. I mean, what is it like? Just one more piece. But it's not just like this one case. And Hillary admitting, yeah, I covered up that he raped her. I cut the bloody underwear out. And giggling like a damn demon. It's like, it's everything. It's total proof. America and the world is being shown the proof.
Right. I mean, just listening to Kathy retell her story about what happened. I mean, and then to know Hillary Clinton took this case voluntarily because she owed a favor to the judge. How does she sleep at night? And then you hear her years later laughing about it and almost so proud of how she was able to manipulate the law. And I think
that's, I came, I saw he died. Ha ha ha.
That's what people need to understand about her is that this was kind of the foundation. This sets the precedent for the type of principles that Hillary Clinton has. Once again, here she is on the wrong side of history. As Candace says, you know, time and time again, she's taken the side of rapists, throwing the victims under the bus. And, you know, this is the tactic she uses again and again. Oh, well, you want to accuse my husband of sexual assault? Well, I'm going to accuse you of sexual assault. Oh, I set up an illegal server. Well, guess what? You have a server, too. It's connected to Russia. And then she says, well, I'm a champion of women. But behind the scenes, she's working tirelessly to get off a rapist who raped, nearly murdered a sixth grader. And she knew he was guilty.
I've got a 12-year-old daughter. And I tell you, this makes me, I'm not just saying it for audience, it actually really gets to me. It pisses me off.
Me too. I mean, this Hillary Clinton is pathological. Just the fact that she can, she's a pathological liar. That
well,
she
Leanne,
can come
you know
out
my 12-year-old daughter. I mean, can you imagine anybody's 12-year-old daughter this happening to?
No. I mean, I was a 12-year-old girl. I know what it feels like. So I can't imagine Hillary Clinton blaming Kathy that she asked for it at 12 years old. As if you have any understanding of what it is.
And then ruining somebody's life, I would say, to a great extent. We'll talk about that with Kathy Shelton ahead. I mean, obviously, you've had a good life, but, I mean, this has got to be traumatic. Leanne, stay there. We'll be right back straight ahead. Infowars.com. Kathy Shelton broke down during the break and has been sobbing here. And she's been trying to compose herself. I know it's hard for her to talk about this, but this is the real humanity of what Hillary Clinton has done to people. And I just can't imagine, you know, it's one thing for bad things to happen, but I'm told if justice is done sometimes, that you know, provides some form of relief. Why when you heard Leanne talking, or I guess I was talking about what happens to young girls, how it changes their lives, you began to break down as we went to break. Why did you break down?
Because of all the things I read about Hillary, everything, books, movies, she's got me in it, and it's like, it's funny. It's her first case. It's like, it's funny it happened to me. It don't mean no remorse to her or nothing. and she's supposed to be for women and children. But this is funny. Oh, I won my first case, and you know, and it's all funny and all the stuff she's written.
That is rubbing it is the cackling. She makes a failed state in Libya. They kill tens of thousands, almost 100,000 people. She starts, and then she makes jokes about it.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, but even her own staff admit in the WikiLeaks, they hate her. They can't stand her. They say she has horrible judgment. They call her a demon, basically.
And somebody who's just comes off as a mediocre, unlikable candidate in person. She doesn't have that humanity.
But there are corporate interests that want to put her in because she'll do the things nobody else will. Kathy, anything else you'd like to add?
She says that I went blank. I'm sorry.
No, it's okay. It's okay. I just
and me getting torn down a little bit. It's got me kind of going blank. But
no, I understand. Well, I mean, what made you so
she's
upset?
She's totally made me look like I'm a liar and that I've asked for this. Trust me, if I could turn all this around, I would rather it not happen and me not have to go through all this. But actually, right now, I'm actually kind of being re-dramatized again, having to get up and tell all this. But you know what? Somebody's got to stand up and tell the truth. Because she sure ain't. She's just going to make it, you know. Oh, well, that was my first case I got off, so, hey, it looks good. I don't care what happened to her.
Well, you're protecting other people. You're protecting other people. You've transcended her 1,000 times, and you're helping other people, and you're a human, and she's not. Let's just be honest. Leanne?
I want to say one more thing. She's also said that I came from the other side of the tracks, ever what that's supposed to mean.
Oh, she hates anybody that's poor or a minority. She really hates poor people. And then she claims she's this big champion. What do you think? We're going to break back with Lee and everybody and extend us a little bit into Gerald Celente because it's so important. What did you think of meeting with Trump, him having a press conference, him bringing you there?
Hillary's never showed no remorse. The first time I met Donald Trump, he hugged me and he said, I am so sorry for what happened to you. And Hillary has never once shown me any remorse of any kind. It's like she laughs. She doesn't care.
Well, for a fact, Trump loves America. He's not perfect, but he hates seeing us get screwed over. That's why the whole corrupt elite are against him. How obvious is it that the whole bad group we don't like is against this person? I mean, it's a no-brainer.
Oh, I think, yeah, not even a comparison. And anything that Trump has been accused of saying does not compare to what Hillary Clinton has chose to do for 40 years of her career.
We're going to come back in 70 seconds. I want Leanne to chime in. I saw Leanne got some tears in her eyes. My sister works here. She takes photos, does a great job, and does editing for us. Because they admit he pled to this. He, you know, this went on. This happened. And she brags and tells people. We played the clip earlier. I don't know if it came across on AM radio, but it comes on FM. I mean, she just makes fun of how she got him off and covered up the blood on his underwear when he raped this girl. I mean, Hillary Clinton is a goddamn demon. Excuse me. That's what she is. Danny Williams is going to pop in with an exclusive. Bill Clinton's reported illegitimate son. Big press conferences happen at the start of the next segment. Then Gerald Celente is coming on. He's been on fire. TheirLivesFoundation.net. But I see Leanne's in there really wound up. They did a brief interview for the Nightly News before this, but I want to ask you guys if you have the time, after you have lunch, you take a break, to go with Leanne, you know, in that studio and talk about what comes after the election. Because we were on the same. I said, what comes next? Exactly what I was thinking. We need to, like, draw attention to this just for women, period, and how it's powerful people and their connections that get away with this type of abuse, whether it's our Bill of Rights, our Constitution, you know, whatever the case may be. But you were telling me, Kathy, about the threats, and you've got to have security, and importantly, how mad Hillary is.
Yeah, I've heard that she, her and her husband both killed off people for less than what I've done, and she's really, really mad. And I've had one night where I had to call the law at my house. There was people messing around. They didn't find nobody, but they've even offered me security, afraid that she or Clinton might put somebody up to hurting me.
Yeah, the state police in Arkansas have gone public and said that the Clintons have just have a murder machine going.
Yeah, it's a scary thing.
I don't think they're going to get you, sweetheart, because you've spoken out and you've gone through their intimidation.
We've taken measures to make sure that Kathy is protected because you live right there in Arkansas, and I've been out there enough over the years doing the research into Clinton women accusers to know that it is not always easy to trust any branch of law enforcement out there because there are still so many Clinton connections.
Well, it's the Dixie Mafia and the KKK, and it's that group within everything that's doing all this stuff. And sometimes people are going to start pushing back. You know, this is a two-way street in this world. We're trying to fix this peaceably. And I think we are starting to turn the tide, but man, people just better watch it. That's all I'm saying, because you can't keep pushing forever. Leanne?
Yeah, I mean, I wasn't able to sleep last night just thinking about the story, knowing I was going to speak with Kathy today. It hurts me to know what she had to go through as a 12-year-old girl riding her bike to church, but yet Hillary Clinton thinks that she can just throw her away, because she's from the wrong side of the tracks. Mm. And that's what I want women and supporters of Hillary Clinton to understand, that this is who she is. This was decades ago.
And she said that on record. It's okay that she covered up because you're somebody from the wrong side of the tracks.
Right. And that she be willing to do this because she has to do a favor to one of her big time donors to her husband's campaign. And so we see her doing that now repeatedly throughout history. That's why she's got all these scandals, is that she's doing these favors for her big donors, regardless of if it's ethical or right for the country or not, and just throws people under the bus to get her way, to claw her way to the top. She doesn't care who she destroys on the way there. And, Candace can kind of speak to just the tactics that she used to violate Kathy again, as she is like interrogating her, trying to get this vicious rapist off. She interrogates this 12-year-old girl, puts her on trial, so to speak, and forces her to defend herself. You know, why are you
That's
asking?
Right, Leanne, I want you to, after lunch, to continue into another in the in-depth interview with these ladies, since we've flown them here, got them here. Other points you'd like to make?
I think that she has put me through what no 12-year-old should ever be put through. My life has never been the same. I've been through counseling 13 to 15 years due to it. If she was for women and children, she wouldn't put a 12-year-old through that. There's no way. Not only have I been traumatized once, but I would say that probably two or three times more I've been traumatized with stuff that I've had.
40-something-year-old women grab a girl out of the middle of town and take her out to fields. Right there, you're all going to prison. That's kidnapping. I mean, I tell you, it's a good thing that guy. Wow. All right, ladies, you're amazing. Kathy Shelton, theirlivesfoundation.net. Candace Jackson helping head up theirlivesfoundation.net. Nightly News Tonight will have more on this with Leanne McAdoo and another special report. You guys go have some lunch. Everybody, dry your tears, and we're going to come right back with Gerald Celente. But first, we're going to talk to Danny Williams, exclusive as well. But God bless you, sweetheart.
Thank you.
Thanks for your courage.
I appreciate it.
We'll be back. We're going to have, I need to cut some promos on this because we're only 6 days, 5.5 days out now. We're going to go Monday, Tuesday, and through Wednesday, a 50-plus hour broadcast from 11 a.m. Monday right through 24 hours, the whole Tuesday. And then right into Wednesday until after the show at 3 o'clock. So that's 52, 54 hours, something like that. That is coming up. Infowars.com/show. A lot of the broadcast is picked up on AM and FM affiliates and UHF and VHF and cable stations. But you can find everything at Infowars.com/show. And we are going to be covering the election live. We're going to have people calling in with the reports of election fraud that's already happening everywhere. We've caught the mother load of it. That's coming up. Gerald Celente, who's been on fire, is joining us. The word is the biggest WikiLeaks are set to drop in the next 3 days, so get ready for that. I was given info by a high-level source last night and again this morning that was so big, I could not believe I was getting the information. And this person's always been 100% on. So I called another source, and they're like, yeah, okay, I just learned that. How do you know that? And I'm not going to get into who I'm talking to. Let's just say it's as high as you get. The mainstream media, whatever. Let me tell you, it's great, though, after 21 years on air, to just see God's plan working and where we've come to in this fight. I mean, it's just amazing. it's the good people standing up. No matter what color your skin is, we all got red blood, and we just want prosperity in the future and some kind of system that's basically fair. And we know globalism and Hillary Clinton and Ned. So Gerald Celente is coming up to start the next segment. One of the top trends forecasters out there. Danny Williams, you know, very nervous 2 years ago contacting us and Joe Biggs on Facebook. And I'm like, yeah, okay, I remember interviewing his aunt. Yeah, it looks like Bill Clinton probably is. I mean, sure. But then, you know, you talk to Danny, he's working, taking care of his kids, five kids. You know, he wasn't, you know, we were trying to get him on. But now that the campaign's big, he's now been able to speak out because this is the season to expose it. And he was nervous when he was in the studio with us, but he did a great job. Seeing him at the National Press Club with like 100 people in the room and dozens of cameras, or more than that, CNN, Fox, you know, Russian TV, Japanese TV, I'm told. He did a great job. And he really let it all out. And I was just watching him during a break because we, you know, we obviously were cutting in during a break. Just his mannerisms just looks like Bill Clinton. And they never did a maternity test. They did a fake test. That's all come out. Why don't they just repudiate it? It's exciting to see this going so viral because it just adds into how fake these people are and how rigged it is. So, Danny Williams, I won't keep you long. I know you're busy. Thanks for this exclusive interview after the press conference, and thanks for Joel Gilbert. Because I remember saying weeks ago, hey, you ought to have a National Press Club conference. I didn't know that got picked up on, or maybe somebody else thought of it too. But then suddenly I hear yesterday, oh, that press conference is happening. I'm supposedly running everything, and I learned about it yesterday. So tell us, you know, how this came to be, where this is going. What you called for today was pretty amazing.
Right. Me and my friends, we got together and we had to set up another press conference. Actually, it came to be about for us to YouTube, my YouTube channel being kicked out. And we wanted to get the message out to Monica Lewinsky for us trying to get a blue dress for the DNA sample of my father's. But it also went great. It went excellent.
No, it did. And I know your buddy's there throwing points, and he can jump in anytime he wants because this is all so important, Danny. And you're going through this for the first time. You've been trying to meet your dad. I remember interviewing your aunt when you were like 6, 7 years old, 20 years ago. And I remember hearing you in the background while she was on the show talking about it. Bill Clinton giving you the presents, the money, all of it. If he would have just embraced you, it would have been some big positive instead of trying to cover it up.
Yes, sir.
Well, the press conference went really, really well. Some folks tried to attack you, but this time, you know, it wasn't just press that was against you. Other points you'd like to add?
Right. I want to thank Fox News and CBS for coming out. They came out today. The whole their position is showing support. But also, you know, I want to get this out. Hillary has the power to get Bill to submit to a DNA test. So I just want to ask her, please, to have your husband step up and submit to a DNA sample.
Absolutely. When was the first time you were told that Bill Clinton was your father?
Well, I've been told all my life, but the age of 8 or 9 was when I really realized what was really going on and who was my father. So, I've been knowing all my life. Since a kid, they've been pointing, you know, and when I was 3, 4 years old, my uncle and them used to stick their hands through my hair and say, look at little Bill Clinton son with this curly hair, you know, and all this. So, I've actually been told that all my life. But to really be understanding and know for myself, I was like 8 or 9 years old.
Well, the media keeps trying to act like you just came up with this. This has been in the newspapers for 20-something years. You've always said this. The Clintons always dodge it. They act like we're doing this now because of the campaign season. Well, obviously, these people are liars. We're trying to force it now because now we can get attention on something.
Right. And correct. And it's not that I've been just now doing it. I've been doing this. I've been coming out on the media and social media for 2.5 years. And, you know, it's actually why now the media is giving me the attention. It's because, you know, she's running again, and it just also give me another chance to show the world and let them know that, you know, Bill Clinton is my father, and I'm trying to prove it.
Well, as you pointed out over and over again, you're not attacking him, any of it. You just want to meet your father, or you just want to have the paternity test, and he could do that right now. Now, I wonder, if Monica Lewinsky's going to respond.
Right. I hope she does. And I just want to be accepted by my father and my stepmother. And, you know, and I hope and pray that, you know, Monica Lewinsky will step up and, or, you know, just at least coming back on in and let us know, you know, is she willing to do it or if not, you know.
That's right. All right. Well, great job, Danny. I know you're really tired. You've done a lot today. By the way, you look sharp in that suit. But I got to tell you, you look just like your dad, and no wonder they're running from this. And I just think it would have been a big positive if they had come out and admitted this. This would have been incredible instead of covering it up.
Yes, sir. I mean, like I say, now that I got my own kids and raising my own kids, I've been raising my own kids since 2003. And, you know, to go through everything and seeing them grow, and my oldest, she's 13. So to see my oldest grow for 13 years, it was something I missed out on, seeing my father watching me grow. So it's just something that always been eating me up. And I, like, since a kid, I always wanted to know, you know, is he really my dad? You know, I need to know.
Sure, just, no, I totally get it. I knew my grandparents, and they're gone, and I want to see them every day. It's this weird thing. I knew them. And then I would certainly want to know my dad. Danny, thank you so much. Again, the YouTube got shut down, 20 million views. They had to bring it back. We put a big protest out, so at WND.com. They're trying to shut down your Facebook. The point is, they're not responding. They're trying to shut you down. People should certainly be supporting you. And by the way, you've had to quit your job for a while to even do this. They attacked the fact that people try to help them with plane tickets and stuff to cover this. How can people support what you're doing and get your message up?
We got a GoFundMe up on my page, and you can find it at Danny Williams on my Facebook page. You can find my GoFundMe, and basically, I just been asking for help from the, help from the people in general. You know,
and by the way, you didn't ask me for this. You didn't ask me to try to support you. I mean, I appreciate you and what you're doing, and what you're doing. You know, I'm trying to take care of your five kids. You know, all from one woman that you're, you know, is a great father. So we appreciate you and your courage and everything else. We'll talk to you soon, Danny Williams. Great job.
Thank you, Alex.
All right, folks, there he goes. And it's only $3,000 he's raised. I mean, I learned he was flying out here on his own and paying for his own hotels and, like, selling his car and stuff. And I said, that's it. I'm giving you $3,000. They made a big deal about that on Media Matters, like they got some secret. That came from me. You guys pay to fly me up to be on some national TV show. If I pay to fly somebody here, that's not bad. I'm not discredited. I'm sick of the lies. We're open about what we do. We're not hiding anything. We're good. We care about people. Now, briefly, we got 24 hours left on the highest quality storable food out there at the lowest prices. It's already a great deal normally at InfoWarsStore.com, powered by My Patriot Supply. Normally, it's 10% off even their prices that are the best out there. Now we have 30 to 40% off, a limited time special. We only do a couple times a year. Used to it was once a year, then maybe twice a year. Now it's like five times a year because people understand now's the time to do storable food. InfoWarsStore.com or call toll free. We can answer all your questions, 888-253-3139. Special diets, you name it. And we've got a big Pro Pure Gravity Fed G2 King Gravity Filter, the best unit they've got, 30% off right now at InfoWarsStore.com as well. And please don't forget, we're getting like 100,000 subscribers a week on YouTube right now. The show is just exploding, obviously, on every front. Sign up for the free newsletter in case they censor us. We can get key intel to you, special coupon codes, you name it. Infowars.com/newsletter. Be sure and do that. And then don't forget our sponsors, Harvest Right. I mean, I've got a Harvest Right. I've had it for 5 years. It's the best dehydrator out there at the lowest price. A great American company. HarvestRight.com. I'm so glad we finally got them as a sponsor. Harvest Right created the most amazing home appliance, a home freeze dryer that helps you be prepared. The appliance allows you to freeze dry your own food at home. Freeze dryer locks in 100% of the food's nutrients, so even 25-year-old food is healthy, as tasty as the day you made it. That means you shoot a deer during the collapse, folks. You don't have to eat it all in one day before it goes bad. You freeze dry it. You can freeze dry fruits such as garden produce, proteins, even whole meals like lasagna and beef stew. Harvest Right sent us some of their freeze dried food, and it's amazing. Tastes so good. Visit harvestright.com or call 800-594-4635. 800-594-4635. Harvest Right. And don't forget InfoWars.com. If you don't have a dime to spend with us to fund the operation, that's fine. Spread the links, the articles, everybody you know. Gerald Celente, straight ahead. All right, Gerald Celente is our guest for the rest of the hour.
The hairs on your arm.
I really appreciate him joining us. He was really on fire when he joined us last week. He's going to be joining us a couple times next week during the 50-plus hours of live coverage that goes from 11 a.m. Monday right through the next day and then right through the end of the show on Wednesday. TrendsResearch.com. I'm going to go over his bio. Everybody knows who Gerald is. He wants to get into the propaganda of fascist Italy. The next long segment's coming up. This is a short six-minute segment. We'll look at the latest developments with him. But first off, we have the New York Times. Investigation into Donald Trump's FBI sees no clear links to Russia. This made-up thing about a server, they admit's fake. The exact same thing Hillary's doing with a secret server to China, Russia, Saudi Arabia. Everything Hillary is doing is turning to pure crap. What is happening? Has the dam broke? What's happening, Gerald Celente?
Well, crap in, crap out. And that's all it is. It's McCarthyism, blaming Putin and Russia for what's going on to divert the real issue. And it's quite disgusting how they're doing it, and there's nothing new about this. I mean, she's fond of calling Putin the new Hitler. When her husband overthrew the leader of Yugoslavia, he was a Hitler. So they throw that word around a lot, and they're using this to divert the real attention. And the biggest story to me here, Alex, is what these WikiLeaks are showing us, how the country is really run, and how we're just all the little people in Slavelandia, as the dirty deals are being done at the top of the heap, how people are getting jobs, getting paid off, how the multinationals are in control of virtually everything. And again, when Hillary was asked at the last, quote, debate, they're not debates, they're presidential reality shows. You have 2 minutes to answer a question about foreign policy, that she was quoted in a speech saying she wanted open borders and open trade and more growth for globalization. She diverted it by saying that, you know, that Trump was in bed with Putin. And so they just divert the issues. It's McCarthyism at its height right now, getting the people to hate Russia while they're diverting the reality.
I agree, Gerald. And since you mention it, the blinders really have come off. We're learning that everything you covered, I covered, Ron Paul talked about forever, we've all been vindicated. Special interests, globalists, they want us poor, they are dumb, they admitted, they want a monopoly, they don't want a middle class. It's the opposite of prosperity in the Renaissance. These are true dirtbags that want us poor.
Yes, and again, the numbers are there. You know, since 1988 to now, real income, when adjusted for inflation, is flat. It's below 1999 levels.
They want a nation of renters, so they want us poor. Trump is bucking that. That's why the whole system's against him. Could it be clearer?
Yeah, it's the whole populist movement. People are fed up with the elites. Again, what I'm saying is what WikiLeaks has showed us is how the elites are running the game. And the most important part of this, as I see it, this is only one little grain of sand of leaks from all. This is only from one guy.
It's one guy. Exactly. And it's total.
Could you imagine if we got more information from all the criminals out there that like to call themselves Republicans and Democrats that are shafting us?
By the way, you're right. The Republicans are just as involved. That's why they're trying to block the populist movement.
Exactly. And by the way, after this election, as a matter of fact, it's going to be one of our top trends for 2017, populism. The conservative, the quote, old conservative Republican Party is dead. It's as dead as McCain, as empty as McConnell, and as
the Bushes,
as stupid as Lindsey Graham. And so what we're saying is, though, Alex, what we're looking at is just a tiny peephole into this elitism through Podesta's emails.
That's a great point. This is only a tiny peephole. Imagine. This is like totally insane. This one email, the whole press can't even cover the corruption. These people are like demons, just corruption. Can you imagine one guy, the corruption's so bad, the whole media can't track it. Can you imagine the thousands of them, what it's really like?
That's exactly what I'm saying.
No, you crystallized it. You had an original thought there, which I don't mean that patronizing. Almost no one does. That totally just blew me away. No one said that yet. This is only one people. Charles Valente's done it again. Oh, my God. Can you imagine if we had all their emails? I mean, these people have demonic energy. I'm telling you. Hillary herself was running 4 or 5 networks and all the major newspapers approving stuff herself through her aides. How do they do this much work? You know, the animating contest of liberty is here. And people think you die, whether you believe in God or not. What you stand for, what you write, what you build, the culture you create goes on and lives through others. It's like ancient cave drawings would be a loving testament to those of the future, not through some arrogance, but with a need to go on and commune with our own species. Empathy is the true mark of consciousness. And the need to build others up, including yourself, is civilization. And the American experiment, not perfect, but the greatest ever, became the apple of the world's eye. And people came here to experience the limited freedom we had. And then it created incredible wealth. It created the biggest government the world's ever seen because a parasite could be created to feed off that magnificent host. And now that parasite is so twisted, it wants to kill its host because it's in competition with it. That shows the blindness of the system. And so Trump, an imperfect messenger, as we all are, is trying to unseat that monopoly and believes in the engine of freedom. And that's why they're in a full panic mode, because anyone in my life I've noticed who's really a smart person involved, who's lived, is confident, is strong, but is, not, I don't want to say prideful, but is so confident they're not arrogant. And they have understandings of their limitations. You look at, though, these people that have been given everything and that are all about the special interest they're in, it's all about who's the most delusional, who's the most mindless, who believes they're invincible. And that leads us to destruction. So Gerald was getting into where we currently are, the giant populist awakening that I'd say dwarfs in magnitude the Gutenberg printing press 550 years ago by 500 times, 1,000 times, with all the technology, all the compression of time, all the things that are changing, all the things that are happening, all the connections that are going on. We're seeing a giant corporate elite siphon off our ideas and try to suppress innovation because it knows it's threatened by it, even as it wants to rise on that sea. It's just not going to work that way. And so they will lose unless they cause a nuclear war and kill us all. So Gerald Celente is our guest. I want to get into what he sees with the campaign the last 5.5, 6 days, where this is going. A lot of top pollsters, even Democrats, admit there's been a collapse for Hillary, a total repudiation of this whole synthetic, fake, corporatist, liberal, neocon system. I'm not hedging bets here. Even if they steal it from Trump or he loses or whatever, we shouldn't get violent. Because culturally, it's the beginning of the end. It's clear that the organic, true drive of human liberty is absolutely unstoppable. Gerald Celente, my friend, take over.
Well, you know, going back to these WikiLeaks, the other point, of course, is, and again, this is only a grain of sand looking into the whole corrupt system. And again, this is supposed to be a democracy. We should have access to these things. But having said that, we now know it's a fact how rigged the media is. And of course, I call them prostitutes. And Donna Brazile, of course, lived up to that in full fashion, as did the people that helped her along, the ones in the other media as well. They're nothing more than sellouts. And so there is no free media. And it's also important for people to understand that the whole fourth estate, as they used to call it, to look after the executive branch, the judicial branch, and the congressional branch, that's gone. In the last 2 weeks, Wall Street Journal announced massive layoffs. New York Times, Gannett News Service, massive layoffs. There are no feet on the street. There's no beat on the street anymore. It's gone. So we're not getting news. And the news that we're getting, as we're seeing, is totally rigged. So anybody believes in a free media, you better grow up. And I can show more of the proof. What I do each day, I get 3 hardcover newspapers delivered, besides, of course, all the going on the internet. I get the Financial Times, the Wall Street Journal, and the New York Times. So here's today's Wall Street Journal, the front page. Trump amps up criticism of Clinton. Democrats attack Department of Justice probe pledge, right? All right, so there's a story about what's going on with the latest leaks and the Department of Justice action. But here's the front page of, they call themselves the New York Times, the paper of record, but as everyone knows, I call it the toilet paper of record because that's all it's really good for. Here's the front page, a wonderful picture of Hillary Clinton smiling on the top, and the right-hand story, in 1990s crisis, Trump used a tax tactic now banned. Have nothing to do with what's going on now. These are disgusting little human beings. They are prostitutes. They get paid to put out. So let's see who put out this. We have a David Barstow, Mike McIntyre, Patricia Cohen, Susan Craig, and Russ Butner. Yeah, Russ Butner, up whose butt? That's what the crap is that they put out. I could show you more, and I do this on Trends in the News virtually every evening. Here's a story last Wednesday. You look at the front page of the New York Times, a black photo of Trump, very ominous. Under it, what drives Trump? A fear of fading away. What little prostitute person wrote this? Michael Barbaro. You should be ashamed of yourself. You're supposed to call yourself a journalist and you say a fear of fading away? Oh, you decided, little boy? Because when you read this, it's nothing but empty crap.
I was about to say, it's projection. It's the New York Times that's bankrupt with a Mexican kingpin bailing them out. It's the mainstream media fading away. They're the ones fading away.
Exactly. So now, the same day, right, as they had, the next day, rather, after this photo, that was Thursday, Friday, here's Hillary in that famous fake happy smile with Michelle Obama. Yeah, the one that loves the rap stars that sing all those filthy, dirty, disgusting lyrics.
I rape you, that's bitch, Michelle up one Obama. Side, down the other, but it's okay because... Because she said that Trump's been.
Once adversaries, now allies. Hillary Clinton and Michelle Obama, not a word. Not a word about the WikiLeaks. Not a word.
Let me ask you this. They're going bankrupt. They're all collapsing. This is a referendum against them. Whether Trump wins, loses, or draws, they admit they're devastated. Where do they go in the future? Give us the trends. Where do we go as the dinosaur who was discredited now collapses and rolls over dead in front of us?
Well, if she wins, again, look at her. We sent you the links here. You look at her campaign slogan, stronger together. Oh, yeah, stronger together. That was Mussolini.
Yeah, let's stop, because here's the crazy part. Obama and Hillary used communist and fascist terminology and even the same posters. They don't care as long as it's authoritarian. So you've got propaganda of fascist Italy here from the encyclopedia. You sent us this. Gerald, I mean, for TV viewers, I'll show folks a document cam shot. Explain this to people. They think we're dumb, they use fascist terminology.
Yeah, here it goes. National and social unity was symbolized by fascists themselves, the bound sticks being stronger together. So they have these sticks bound with an axe on them. Stronger together than individuality. Stronger together. It's a global takeover. Open borders, globalization, multinationalization, stronger together. It's against individuality. Italians were called to pull together in a unity. Mussolini declared that the state did not weaken the individual. This was a part of explicit rejection of liberal individualism. Furthermore, fascism was to be totalitarianism. Fascism was not a party, but a way of life. You ready for this? The corporatist state was offered as a unifying form of politics as opposed to a liberal democracy.
Sure, that's Roman Empire, which he was bringing back, where you have all the countries they've conquered tied together with a hatchet on the top. That's the symbol of fasci. That's the globalist model today.
Exactly. Stronger together, because individualism doesn't count. Alex, we all have to be politically correct. We all have to speak their language.
So let me ask you this. We'll do that, but explain to me, why do they openly use Karl Marx quotes of lean forward, capture the future, stronger together, Mussolini stuff? And like, can they come up with anything new on their own? Because they use literal authoritarian terminology and their little trendy minions don't get it.
The reason they do it is because they know how effective it is.
It works.
Hey, it worked for Mussolini. It worked for Marx. Why not us? Because all we are psychopaths like the ones that we quoted, and we want to get in control. So they're using a proven methodology that worked very well. Again, stronger together, the words are right there. It was the foundation of fascism because individualism doesn't count. Oh, by the way, it goes back to what you were saying when I was on the last show. You were talking about the driverless cars and how we're all losing control of everything. And that's what this is. It's a totalitarian takeover. Go back to WikiLeaks again. That guy who's running Google, he's
Schmidt.
A big part, right?
Schmidt, I mean, they all admit they're running the whole campaign.
And it's right there in the WikiLeaks. But the toilet paper of record, the New York Times, doesn't have that headline there. Google rigging the elections with Clinton. They don't do that. So that's what I'm trying to say. They know what they're doing. They want a global takeover.
No, they know they're creating a global fascist order based on Rome. That's the admitted whole entire system. I totally agree. That's what Club of Rome admits. It's what Bilderberg admits. So how do we counter it, and what do you expect to see? You're a smart guy. What happens if Trump gets in? What happens if they steal it? What are the two different divergent paths?
There's no stopping the populist movements. They're going on throughout Europe. The alternative for Deutschland Party, they just knocked out Merkel in key areas. You're looking at the Freedom Party in Austria, the Wilders Party in the Netherlands, Le Pen's party in France. You saw the Brexit
Iceland, vote. Catalonia, it goes on and on.
So that's what the future is. It's people power. And your kind of show, what I'm doing, Paul Craig Roberts, others, Ron Paul, that we are the people. You read the WikiLeaks and you see what little creeps these jerks are and how.
Did you see the one 3 weeks ago where they said we want to keep them poor and desperate and in the dark and uninformed? It's so evil.
And again, the toilet paper doesn't put it out there. Listen to Hillary Clinton's speeches at the Goldman Sachs gang. They're telling that.
I'm going to get rid of borders. I'm going to drop down wages. We're going to F everybody.
And that they're out of touch with the middle class.
And by the way, the rich billionaires know they could globally set a higher standard. And so the left says drive up wages, but they mean that in a control system so you don't get a job. No, they mean global wages sunk to the lowest level to make you poor so you can't compete. It's super evil.
And then what they're using is they're using the techno takeover to keep us in control. So that's how they're doing it. They're taking more. We're going back to advertising revenue in newspapers in the last quarter was down 9%. People aren't reading. They're hitting sound bites from Facebook, from Twitter, from Google News. They're dumbing us down. They're getting the masses totally tuned out. And it's going to be up to what Samuel Adams said. It does not take a majority to prevail, but rather an irate, tireless minority keen on setting brush fires of freedom in the minds of men. We're setting those.
I agree. And I think they've backfired thinking they can use AI and algorithms to shut things down because Trump has made it a war between social media and the internet and mainstream media. And we're winning. Humet is beating the algorithm.
And this is just the beginning. That's what we're saying. It's just the start.
So have confidence, folks. And we're not just saying this to put perfume on a pig. Gerald's right. Look at what's happening. They're in panic mode. They're freaking out. This is only the beginning. Realize the power you have and the choices you make, what you buy, what you do, what you say, when you speak out, when you give your opinion, it's not their centralized opinion. When you have an original thought, it's wealth born into the world. You want to fight globalism? Make art.
And that's very important because this isn't not only what I'm saying, I'm listening to what they're saying. They had the World Trade Organization meeting and the IMF, the International Mafia Federation meeting down in Washington, D.C. You read go back to the G20 meeting several weeks earlier. Their greatest fear is the people's repulsive attitude toward globalization. They're saying it out loud.
They admitted in all their main publications to each other, The Economist, Washington Post, Financial Times, globalism's in trouble. Hillary's the last domino. If she falls, we're done. They've admitted, we did rip everybody off. We did lie about globalism. We said it would help everybody. We effed everybody. We've got to be good now. That's just one more con.
And again, you look at the numbers. You realize that trade in the first 9 months of this year, global trade is down almost $500 billion.
Massive.
So the whole thing is failed. And you're seeing the revolts in Italy. They elected a woman, Virginia Raggi, 37 years old, to the mayor of Rome. Another woman elected to the mayor of Turin. You're going to see Renzi being thrown out when his new constitutional referendum is rejected coming up in December. There's a global revolution. It's a off with their heads moment in the sense that the people are fed up with the elites. And you read the WikiLeaks, and the elites are in charge. And the elites are, whether they're prostitutes for CNN, CNBC, CBS, and NPR, all of
they're
them.
They're all trash, and you're right. They thought they would have controlled corporate media when they brought in global government and austerity to control us and make us permanent serf classes. But instead, the internet they built to be a spy grid blew up in their face, and they're now realizing it. So, Gerald, when we come back from break, start now, how do they strike back then? Because they know now they're not as arrogant as they used to be.
Well, they're going to do everything to stop us. And again, InfoWars is the leader out there putting out the message of peace, freedom, trust, loyalty, and morality. Those are words that don't fit into their lifestyle.
I want to get your prediction for the election. Only 5.5 days out with Gerald Celente of TrendsResearch.com. Sign up for his free trends alerts. He also does a daily program just like we do as well. And it's just amazing to see the epic time we're in. We are winning. But will the globalists throw a fit and start a nuclear war to overturn the chessboard? We'll talk about that as well straight ahead. Then Paul Watson from London. One of our great sponsors is United States Gold Vault, based right here in Texas. It's where I personally have gotten some of the latest gold I've gotten and silver. Will you and your family be protected when we have another economic meltdown? I believe an economic crash is coming. It's already happening in many areas of the world, and I protect myself with real money. Do you want to be a victim or do you want to be prepared? Take action with the company I trust, United States Gold Vault. Call them today at 844-321-ALEX. They've created a game-changing gold and silver survival packs. A lot of other great things they have. Ask about those. Filled with physical gold and silver coins that could help safeguard you what you'll need most in a financial crisis, real money, not paper. I've secured my retirement, or at least emergency backup, with gold and silver. Don't wait till it's too late. Call the United States Gold Vault now at 844-321-ALEX. You'll get a rugged double-locking bank bag to securely store your gold and silver absolutely free. That's United States Gold Vault at 844-321-ALEX. And we have 30 to 40% off last day on high-quality storable foods at InfoWarsStore.com. Please don't forget to go sign up for the free news alerts as well. And also sign up and get the quarterly trends journal from Gerald Celente. And speaking of trends, I was just getting into that. Other points we should add, other things people should know, Gerald.
Well, just what you were talking about with gold, and that right now, as we're speaking, gold is up almost $20. The markets are down over 150 points, the Dow. There's fear on the street, and it has nothing to do with whether or not Trump wins. Because if Trump wins and the economy goes, the markets go down, of course, they'll take a shot and blame him. It's much bigger than that. It's a global economy. And so, as I mentioned to you, we're looking at global trade. Those are real numbers, that is down $500 billion. And about the survival packs and all of that, you know, people better start putting their money where their mind is. And of course, I don't give financial advice, but I buy gold and I'm a firm believer of it. And I've been forecasting it for many years.
Well, I mean, if all you're doing is sitting on paper, you're crazy.
Excuse me?
If all you're doing is sitting on paper, you're crazy.
in my estimation, because it's digital money printed on nothing and backed by nothing. So why not have an asset that's been around since the written word, and it's not going anywhere, even though others say it's going to? And again, you're looking at the prices going up as volatility is increasing and the real numbers are coming in. What are we going into now? The sixth quarter of negative.
Well, that's my next question. Clearly, the global meltdown's happening. Deutsche Bank, they say, is in bigger crisis than Lehman Brothers. I mean, how long can they put this off? The Fed admits their QE failed. So what happens?
Well, again, that's what they're trying. They're trying anything desperate. But you know what I say, and you were saying it before, in the sense that about a World War III. Go back to Hillary Clinton's debate, where she said she wants a no-fly zone over Syria. And then you hear the head of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, Dunford, say that that's declaring war against Russia, because Russia was invited there, of course. People don't know that. The Assad government was elected by the people with international observers. The United States is a foreign power that's invading another country.
Trying to put jihadis in control.
So exactly. So when all else fails, they take you to war. And when I say put your money where your mind is, everyone listening out there, if you're not supporting Alex Jones and buying the products that they're selling that are only going to improve your health and put you in a position to avoid the dangers when they happen, then you're being a hypocrite. Because it takes money and time to make these
kinds
of things.
Well, sure, what you're saying is we have to build an economy by what we support, and supporting trendsresearch.com, it's infowars.com. It's everybody telling the truth, taking action together by supporting our sponsors, the products we sell. It builds a larger platform to fight this. We're all in it together. Gerald Celente, I know you're going to join us again next week. Only 5.5-6 days out from election. Thank you so much for your time, my friend.
Thank you for having me on, and thanks for all you do.
You bet. Thank you. Wow. Great guy. He is on fire. He's always on fire, but really on fire right now. I'm going to come back, finish up for 5 minutes, then Paul Watson takes over from London, England. He's got big breaking news. What a full broadcast today. Stay with us. Tomorrow will be 5 days, and then 4 days, 3 days, 2 days, 1 day. Boom. Monday ends, and then we go into Tuesday and the big election, and a lot of people say, hey, why are you showing all this Bev Harris stuff about election fraud? Now they're shaving votes. That'll discredit the election. Maybe we'll not go vote. We have to expose them trying to steal it. Clearly, it's a landslide for Trump. They've skewed the polls. They've skewed the Google. It's all come out in WikiLeaks. They control the media. If Trump wouldn't have resisted and we'd had another milquetoast Republican that had political operatives working for him that were, you know, stepping down, I'll tell you, Ron Paul was a great guy and meant well, but you had people like Jesse Benton that has just absolutely been certified as a piece of filth. And I'm not doing that as some pissing contest to put Jesse Benton down. It's just that hindsight's 2020, and you can just see the crap that's going on. And then now you got Trump like a flame-breathing dragon blasting the globalist. I mean, it's everything we ever hoped for. I mean, he's attacking him on everything. He's devastating them. These issues he's launched, the populist movement that he's taken, InfoWars, and what Ron Paul did in the Liberty Movement, and things going back to Barry Goldwater, and what Drudge has done, and the Western Journalism Center, and Breitbart, and just 5 times, 10 times, 20 times, amplified it. It's global, and it's the spirit of our age, and all over the world, people are pulling out. People know they want self-determination. Humans can have unlimited prosperity. There'll always be somebody with something more than you or I, but it doesn't matter. And some people that stole it, some people that made it, you know, the free market. But you can't end the free market because it's got problems, because what it's compared to is hell on earth. So Paul Watson's about to get in a share here, and I'm going to ask him what's coming up today in the next hour. I know he's got some big breaking news, but we've got the nightly news tonight, 7 o'clock Central. All the different segments of the show were very powerful today, and everything that's happening is extremely powerful right now. We need to focus on the top 20 or so WikiLeaks that have come out in the last few months. A lot of it hasn't gotten proper focus. We need to focus in on how Hillary accuses Trump of everything she does. We need to focus in on other dirty tricks they might pull, and the fact that she wants war with Russia and that she wants war in Syria. And just that she represents all the corporate interests that have hijacked our nation. Now, Paul Watson, tell us, my friend, what is coming up in the next hour as you host from the UK.
Hi, Alex. Yeah, we got Bill Mitchell coming up. He's been listed as one of the top influencers on social media during this election cycle, which is a point that many people have made. You know, Hillary Clinton's got over 10 million Twitter followers. Routinely, myself, InfoWars, people like Bill Mitchell get more retweets, more visibility on Twitter alone. He's an expert on the polls, so we're going to drill down how this post-FBI announcement has affected the polls. Is there a significant shift towards Trump? He's also an expert on how they oversample Democrats for all these polls. So again, we're going to drill into that because he really is the go-to source on these issues.
Wow, so top pollster exposes the Hillary fraud coming up.
Yeah, and obviously, you know, the ABC poll just came out a few hours ago. 12-point shift. Hillary was supposedly, even with the oversampling, 12 points ahead of Trump. Even with that oversampling still in place, she's now lost virtually all of that lead over the past 10 days alone.
I know, and it's a total, just not a conspiracy. It's an exercise in mind control and lockstep that the whole media just ignores this oversampling.
No, every single time. And, you know, the common argument is, well, there are more Democrats registered than Republicans. Bill Mitchell breaks that down. He proves how that's not the case. That's not reflected in these
polls. Well, it's not true because they don't vote as much as Republicans.
Exactly. And there's a lot more enthusiasm behind Trump, which is why we could see a Brexit-style scenario. But even so, the polls are tightening as we move towards the last few days.
Paul Joseph Watson from PrisonPlanet.com, our heavy hitter. Straight ahead on the other side, ladies and gentlemen, my aide-de-camp. Stay with us.
We are live on The Fox Jones Show. As I said before the break, coming up at the bottom of the hour, we've got Bill Mitchell, host of Your Voice Radio, and he really has been the go-to guy when it comes to these polls, how they're oversampling Democrats, what these poll numbers really reflect, especially in the aftermath of Friday's FBI announcement regarding the reopening of the investigation into Hillary Clinton's emails. So Bill Mitchell is coming up at the bottom of the hour. For now, though, we're going to get into some of this breaking news. And again, this story was up on Infowars.com this morning. WikiLeaks, of course, yesterday announced phase 3 of their operation against Hillary Clinton. That's how it's come to be characterized, with more releases of the Podesta emails. But is that all we're going to see from WikiLeaks over the next 7 days? You will notice that one name, one email address that's noticeably absent from all those John Podesta emails is that of Hillary Clinton. Now, there's been speculation which continues to build that those 33,000 deleted Hillary Clinton emails could be released in some form or another by WikiLeaks. And this speculation has started because Kim.com, who of course you will know as the founder of Mega Upload, the entrepreneur, the hacking expert, ever since basically 2014, he gave an interview back in 2014. We know that he's close to WikiLeaks. We know that he talks to Julian Assange on a regular basis. Back in 2014, he tweeted that he would be a major thorn in the side of Hillary Clinton in 2016. Then he went on Bloomberg and gave an interview a few months later and said that Julian Assange would be Hillary Clinton's worst nightmare come the 2016 election. So again, 18 months before the Podesta emails get released, he goes on Bloomberg and predicts that this is going to happen. Now, over the past several weeks, Kim.com has come out and made several tweets hinting that Julian Assange does in fact have access to some, if not all, of these 33,000 deleted emails. This is the headline up on Infowars.com right now. And it's also up on Drudge Report. Is WikiLeaks about to release Hillary's 33,000 deleted emails? Internet security expert Kim.com says that Hillary Clinton is in, quote, serious trouble, with new information set to leak that some speculate could be a WikiLeaks release of Hillary Clinton's 33,000 deleted emails. Again, he made this promise, May 2015, that Julian Assange would be Hillary Clinton's worst nightmare. He admitted, quote, I love to talk to them. He's closely allied with WikiLeaks, with Julian Assange. And again, he predicted that Assange would be Hillary's worst nightmare in 2016, quote, because he has access to information. And of course, that has proven very much accurate. Last week, Kim.com also tweeted at WikiLeaks. This went up last week with a video of himself reacting to a You've Got Mail audio clip hours before he sent out another tweet which stated, bleach bit con bleach it, which of course is a reference to the software tool used by Hillary's campaign to hide traces of her deleted emails. So the question at this point, we know that he's close to Assange. We know that he predicted Assange would be Hillary's worst nightmare because he had access to the information. He's come out with a series of tweets suggesting that there is one more bombshell WikiLeaks release on Hillary Clinton. So if it's going to happen, it's got to happen within the next 7 days. Is Kim.com merely trolling everyone with these constant hints, constant suggestions that there are new bombshell revelations about Hillary to come out in addition to the Podesta emails? Or is he actually serious, and are we going to see another big drop over the next few days? It was interesting that Rush Limbaugh covered this on his radio show on Friday because somebody called in and basically brought this to his attention. And he made the point, quote, in all of these Podesta emails, there's not a single Hillary Clinton email in the bunch. It's Podesta emailing everybody, the DNC, everybody in the Hillary campaign, but there are no Hillary Clinton emails in the Podesta dump. He continues, along comes Kim.com, who's got an axe to grind with the US government, the Obama administration, as has Julian Assange, of course. He knows Assange, so the people. Nobody knows. This is all speculation. What's going on here is that Kim.com has worked with Assange and is really the hacker. It's not the Russians. So that speculation has been raging. It will continue to rage. Of course, we know that there are still thousands of emails from John Podesta's personal email account that are yet to be released by WikiLeaks. We're up to number 25 of the Podesta email dump as of today. Again, that is going to continue right up until election day on November 8th. But is there one more black swan in this epic tale, this epic twist that we've seen, of course, since the FBI announcement on Friday? Is there one more shoe to drop in terms of WikiLeaks releasing some, if not all, of those deleted emails, which, of course, the NSA has had access to and continues to store, according to Kim.com, at its spy facility in Utah? So we're going to keep up with that. We'll keep up with developments. We'll monitor Kim.com's Twitter account for any more suggestions that that might happen. But again, allied to this is more speculation, and this has been brewing for a long time, based on the fact that a biographer for Donald Trump supposedly, and this was in the WikiLeaks emails, this has come out, had 9 hours of personal conversations with Donald Trump. Now, you know that Donald Trump likes to talk off the cuff, as we saw with the Billy Bush tapes, with the locker room banter. Of course, you could record anyone throughout a day for 9 hours straight, and they're going to come up with some pretty fruity remarks. Of course, there could be jokes, they could be taken out of context, there could be anything whatsoever. If you edit them together correctly and create a media firestorm with people who are ready and waiting at the trigger to be offended, then obviously you could come out with some damaging material about Donald Trump. It came out in the WikiLeaks that his biographer, back about 18 months ago, offered the Clinton campaign free access to these 9 hours of recordings of Donald Trump in private conversations. Are they going to pull the trigger on that? People like Ben Shapiro don't think so. They say that the behavior of the Clinton campaign in the aftermath of this FBI announcement, their desperation, their demeanor, suggests that they're all out of ammo and that they have no more dirt to launch against Trump. Of course, with the Billy Bush tapes, the polls in the aftermath of that showed that it probably only affected Trump's polling numbers at a rate of about 1% drop in support. So it didn't really have any impact whatsoever. You had a series of women come out afterwards, make claims that Trump had groped them, that he had sexually assaulted them. And really, that narrative didn't stick. They had no evidence to prove it. Many of their stories were pulled apart almost as soon as they were published. But now we have this headline out of the Ralph Report. Out of real ammo, media now claims Russians have Trump sex tape. So we're beyond the racial remarks, we're beyond the remarks about women. Now some journalists, left-wing journalists, are out on Twitter claiming that there is a Trump sex tape. The article reads, it gets hard to come up with the openings to these posts sometimes. How many ways can you say the mainstream media has sunk to a new low? Over the past 24 hours, they've been pushing a debunked story about Donald Trump being controlled by the Kremlin. Of course, that came out. Even the New York Times had to admit the FBI's looked into those connections and found no evidence whatsoever. But now there are left-wing journalists out on Twitter claiming that there's a Donald Trump sex tape where he's having an orgy with Russian supermodels in Moscow. Fairly unbelievable, but again, a reflection, you might say, of the desperation as we head towards these final days. Would they be that desperate to cook up such a story if they're so confident in the poll numbers, if they're so confident that Hillary Clinton has secured this election? Then you've got another potential black swan, of course, which is James O'Keefe. Again, over the past 2 weeks, we've had absolute bombshell confirmation of what we said all along. The riots, the violence at Trump rallies was funded, directed, organized by the DNC, by surrogates of Hillary Clinton's campaign. That got nowhere near the traction it deserved in the mainstream media. But again, it went absolutely viral on the internet, millions upon millions of views. We had the vote rigging tape on top of that, them talking about bussing people in on a regular basis, openly admitting to violating the law. O'Keefe has said on numerous occasions that he has another tape yet to drop that features surrogates of Hillary Clinton or even operatives within her campaign making racially disparaging remarks. Now, we had the story a couple of weeks ago, which again got about 900,000 views on one YouTube video alone that I uploaded, of the former Clinton chef, Tracy Martin, saying that he witnessed personally on numerous occasions Hillary Clinton making racially disparaging remarks. One particular example, calling a servant the N-word when he displeased her. Of course, that was a claim backed up by no actual evidence. But then again, it was on the same level as all those women who came out with claims against Trump with no actual evidence. The difference is that that got saturation, mainstream media coverage. This got nothing at all. But if James O'Keefe, as he has promised on Twitter on numerous occasions, has an audio tape of Hillary Clinton operatives, or at least surrogates, making racially disparaging remarks, and that, I would estimate, is set to be released either tomorrow or before the end of the week, could that have yet another impact? Of course, the mainstream media is going to do their best to bury it, to try and cover it up, to pretend that it doesn't exist. But again, it's another black swan that we could see in this final week of the election. Is Hillary's campaign content to just ride it out and have confidence in these poll numbers, despite, as we're going to document later, again, many of them are cooked, many of them oversampled Democrats. Do they have enough confidence in those polls to sit and wait this out, or do they have another card to play against Donald Trump? And on the flip side, is there more bombshell to come out about Hillary Clinton from WikiLeaks, from James O'Keefe, or from another direction? We'll be back on the Alex Jones Show after the break. Don't go. We are back live on the Alex Jones Show, fourth hour overdrive. In the next segment, we've got Bill Mitchell, host of Your Voice Radio, coming up to drill down into the polls post-FBI investigation, and we're going to find out if they're going to have a major impact on the election. We're also going to talk about those early voting numbers, try and get a sense of what they're beginning to indicate. But before we get back into the news, I want to tell you about the 30 to 40% off InfoWars Select Storable Food Special. This is the final 24 hours to enjoy that discount at InfoWarsStore.com to save 30 to 40% off on our InfoWars Select Storable Food. Again, 48% of Russians in a poll say that they expect a new world war over Syria. We know that that's more likely if Hillary Clinton gets into office, given that she's promised to use military assets against Russia if it's even suspected of cyber hacking. These are perilous, dangerous times. Governments are storing food, they're storing seeds. So you're not a conspiracy kook if you want to do the same thing and get your hands on some of this food insurance. So again, this is the last 24 hours that you can enjoy this special. With Hillary and her globalist allies trying to steal the election, there's never been a more crucial time to start getting prepared for the future with storable food. 25-year shelf life on all of this storable food, super high quality ingredients. It's made in the USA. There's a reason why FEMA reports predict up to 395% increase in food prices that could trigger mass unrest. Again, this is an insurance against multiple factors. And hey, if nothing happens, then you just eat the food. And it's cheaper than what it would cost you to buy at the grocery store anyway, if you're buying it in bulk. So it's a win-win, whatever way you look at it. Again, governments are warning about civil unrest. We've got 48% of Russians in a poll thinking that there may be World War III over Syria. We've got Russian television telling their citizens where to find nuclear bunkers. Americans aren't being told that by CNN. So again, it's a good idea for you to get prepared. If the government's doing it, you're not a kook for doing the same. 30 to 40% off on InfoWars Select Storable Food. The final 24 hours to enjoy that discount at InfoWarsStore.com. Absolutely crucial. And again, it helps us build this platform to the point where our tweets get more retweets, get more exposure, get more readership than Hillary Clinton's official Twitter account with 10 million plus followers. That's what you have enabled us to build, to take on the mainstream media directly, to crush their narrative as we have during this election cycle by getting the products at InfoWarsStore.com. Let's go back to some news stories. Let's talk about media bias, because of course we had Donald Trump complaining about the media being rigged for weeks and weeks. He was attacked. He was savaged as a conspiracy theorist. Well, a new poll has come out and it finds that the majority, the huge majority of Americans believe the media is biased in favor of Hillary Clinton, which is interesting because only about a week ago, we had a poll that said 55% of Americans thought the media was biased in favor of Hillary. Now it's 75%, according to a Suffolk University USA Today poll, which finds that by an overwhelming margin, Americans believe the media is biased in favor of the Democratic presidential candidate. They were asked, quote, who do you think the media, including major newspapers and TV stations, would like to see elected president, Hillary Clinton or Donald Trump? A whopping 75% of those polled said the media favored Clinton, while only 7% said the media preferred Trump. So that narrative of media rigging, with Donna Brazile feeding Hillary the debate questions the day before, with dozens of reporters going to John Podesta's apartment for cozy dinners before they write major stories, that has now finally translated into the polls, and 75%, a full three-quarters of Americans, now believe that the media is overwhelmingly biased in favor of Hillary Clinton. Again, up 20 percentage points from a different poll that was taken just a week or 10 days previously. So again, it exemplifies how that narrative has really took hold. It's not took hold with the media itself, which continues to be completely biased. This is an article out of Newsbusters study, Big Three Networks Attack Comey Over Clinton by 3-1. Ever since it was announced that the FBI was pursuing new leads into the investigation of Hillary Clinton's email server scandal, the big three, ABC, CBS, and NBC, have gone into attack mode against James Comey, turning what should be a scandal about Clinton into a smear about the FBI director. Beginning with the evening, October 28th, of the announcement through Monday, MRC analysts reviewed all statements, found that when the media took a position on Comey and Clinton, arguments against Comey were 88 compared to those against Clinton, which were 31. That's a ratio of almost 3-1 where the mainstream media is savaging, is attacking the FBI director Comey while absolving Hillary Clinton, who should be the target of their ire, for blame. So again, another direct example of the media being rigged. The good news is the polls now show Americans are finally starting to realize it. We'll be back after the break with Bill Mitchell. This is the Alex Jones Show.
We're on the march.
This is the Alex Jones Show Live. I'm Paul Joseph Watson. We're going to go to our guest now, who is Bill Mitchell, host of Your Voice Radio at yourvoiceradio.com. And as I said beforehand, consistently listed as one of the top influencers on social media during this election cycle. Again, you can go to his Twitter account. He's posted the impressions that he gets for his tweets alone. It's almost at 200 million every month at this point. And it's the same with a lot of people, Cernovich, myself, we're absolutely crushing them to the point now where Hillary Clinton's tweets get less retweets than ours despite the fact that she's got national attention and 10 million plus followers. That's how we're winning the narrative on social media. Of course, he's also an expert on the polls, which we're going to delve into. Bill, welcome to the show.
Hi, how are you? Nice to finally meet you face to face, sort of.
Good to speak to you. Now, I wanted to get into the polls straight away because, of course, that's your primary focus. We've seen in many of them, at first they tried to claim that there was very little shift. But after the FBI announcement, for example, you know, this ABC poll today, we've got, what, a 12, 13-point shift away from people supporting Hillary. In the numbers we've seen so far since the FBI announcement, is this shift in support towards Trump quantifiable? Do you think it could be what tips things in Trump's favor come November the 9th?
You know, I've been saying all along that this is a change election. We have approximately 72% of the electorate that is unhappy with the direction of this country. This is very similar to 1980. And I've been saying all along that all of the polls, all of the debates, all the ads, all the gotchas and scandals in the end really don't matter as much as the fact that in a change election, the change candidate wins, period. And in this election, Donald Trump is the change candidate. And what we've had in this race is a very high level of undecideds, even within a week or two of the election, you know, 16 points undecided. And what happens in a change election, and this happened in 1980 as well, in the final week, those undecideds go towards the challenger. And the challenger in this case is Trump. The status quo candidate is Hillary. So I think that what's happening with this FBI thing is everybody saying, oh, it's the FBI thing is changing everything. I think it was changing anyway. I think the FBI thing doesn't hurt. It's sort of the icing on the cake. It ties a bow around it. But, you know, I really believe that this was taking place anyway. And we've seen in this election cycle some very strange sampling. If you look back at 2008, for instance, in the primaries, the Democrats had a turnout. It was approximately D plus 8 over the Republicans. So they had about 8% more turnout than the Republicans did. Apologize, I thought I had turned this off. Forgive me. Apologize for that. Okay, but anyway, the Democrats had about 8% more turnout in the primaries than the Republicans did in 2008. In the general election, they had about 7% more turnout. So there was a correlation between the primary turnout and the general election turnout. Then back in 2000, under Bush, it was almost the same. Very similar. Republicans had slightly higher turnout in the primaries. They had slightly higher turnout in the general election. This time, Republicans had a plus one turnout over Democrats in the primaries. Okay, we had about 1 million votes more in the primaries than Democrats. And it was actually higher than that because Trump wrapped up the nomination a month before Hillary did. So if that our nomination process had gone on as long as Hillary's did, it would have been even greater, okay? So if we go back with the same correlation that we had in 2000 and 2008 between the primaries and the general, we should be looking at polls with maybe R plus zero, R plus one, D plus one samples. Instead, for instance, this ABC poll has a D plus 10 sample. That's 3 points better than Obama experienced in 2008 when he had a landslide. 70,000 people at his rallies, sold out his merchandise, dominated social media, had a best-selling book, had people fainting at his rallies. I mean, there was all this visible empirical evidence on the ground that Obama was dominating. Hillary has none of that, and yet pollsters are factoring in a victory in a landslide higher than Obama experienced, despite the fact that we won the primary battle. So I've been saying all along, folks, and they know this on the Democrat side, this is not a D plus 10 election. This is not a D plus 8 election. At the most, this is a D plus 0 to D plus 2 election. And take all these polls right now that are either tied or with Hillary winning and apply a D plus 0 or a D plus 2 sample of those, and Trump wins every one, some of them by a lot. And that's the reality of this election right now.
So you're saying this argument that there are likely to be 8-9% more Democrats voting is completely disproven by the primaries. Why do you think they do this? Is it just that's what they've always done? Or are they trying to instruct, are they trying to manipulate public opinion to the point where, you know, Trump voters think, well, this is a losing battle. Trump has no chance of winning, so we're not going to bother to vote. Is it? I mean, we saw that referenced in the WikiLeaks, didn't we? So are they doing it deliberately to form this kind of narrative that Hillary's victory is inevitable?
Yeah, I think so. I think what they were trying for is they realized that Hillary is a very weak candidate here. She is a status quo candidate when the electorate is unhappy with the status quo. She can't really get out on the campaign trail. And campaign, what is she supposed to do? You know, campaign as a change candidate at the same time praising Obama, you know? It's a real problem here. So what they were trying to do is they were trying to go for an early knockout. It's like a boxing match where if you are not as good of a boxer as the person you're up against, you go out swinging for haymakers, looking for the early knockout so that, you know, you can take them out early, because they knew that Hillary would never survive a 15-round match against Trump. And because of social media and guys like yourself, guys like me, guys like Cernovich, because we have balanced out the media and kept everybody off the ledge, we've survived through 15 rounds, and now the points are adding up in our favor, and we're going to win the victory.
And again, we keep hearing the question over and over again. There's so much enthusiasm behind Trump. Thousands and thousands of people. In fact, I think that the attendees at the Pence rallies outnumbered those for Kaine and Clinton combined. Yeah. So much enthusiasm, seemingly little enthusiasm behind Hillary. But I mean, I posted a meme yesterday which said, you know, the problem isn't that Hillary is an unethical, corrupt, lying, criminal dirtbag. Everyone knows that. The problem is that her supporters don't care. I mean, do Hillary supporters care? What do the polls show, for example, about how many Hillary-leaning supporters care about the corruption, care about this FBI investigation? Is it going to deter them from voting for her?
Well, you know, I wanted to point out something in what you just said about the rally size that a lot of people don't get. It's a deeper thing to that, is that in 2008, Obama had huge rallies, okay, big rallies. In 2012, he didn't. Okay, so what was the difference? Well, in 2008, there were a lot of people that were new to the process, young people, black voters that had not voted before, that were new to the process. They wanted to experience it. They wanted to be out there. They wanted to go to the rallies. They wanted to see it. In 2008 or 2012, he didn't have big rallies anymore, even though he's the same guy, because most of his voters were experienced voters, old hat voters. So what we're seeing right now, we keep talking about the monster vote in this election. This is the 20 million people that were registered to vote in 2012. It didn't. It's the millions more than that that were eligible to vote and aren't even registered. So millions and millions of voters out there. And what we're seeing is that Trump's rallies are so big because so many people going to those rallies are first-time voters, just like Obama experienced in 2008. Because old hat experienced voters don't tend to go out to rallies and stuff like that. Yeah, I've heard it, I can watch it on TV. They don't feel the need to experience it, you know? So what we're seeing in these huge rallies for Trump is all this enthusiasm of what's called the monster vote. And what's key about the monster vote is nobody is polling it because nobody knows who it is. Now, there is one poll that shows us who the monster vote is. That's the primary turnout. And all the pollsters are ignoring that. Okay, so not only are they oversampling Democrats in these polls, they're undersampling the monster vote because they say, well, we can't know what it is. Because when they call you for a poll, when they're trying to do a likely voter screen, they say, have you voted in the last two elections? No. Okay, you're not a likely voter. Well, that excludes all the monster vote. Okay, so not only are they oversampling Democrats, they're undersampling the monster vote. So we're setting ourselves up for a tremendous, tremendous win here for Trump that, I mean, could, you know, shake the political landscape for a long time.
There's another aspect to this which ties into what you were talking about. Of course, Brexit. Immediately before the Brexit vote, the Remain camp was 4 points ahead. The exit polls had them ahead. They were all over the news bragging that it was over within minutes. We know what happened. Brexit won by a numerous million votes, comfortable margin in the end. Is there an aspect to this where, you know, they phone up Trump supporters, they ask, how are you going to vote? And purely through a kind of social stigma alone, many Trump supporters don't want to state on the phone or in public that they're going to vote for Trump. But actually, when it comes down to it, they're going to vote for Trump. Is that a significant amount of people? Is this social stigma thing an actual phenomenon that you think could have an impact?
Sure. I think they call it the shy Tory effect, where people didn't want to say what they really thought. There's a certain amount of that. One of the big problems with polling right now is they call it scientific polling because it's supposed to be a scientifically random sample. But the problem is that there is a response bias that's taking place in polling now that basically means that there are no random samples out there. There are no scientific polls anymore. Back when Reagan was running for office, you got about a 45 or 50 or 60% response rate, meaning the pollster would call your house, you'd answer the phone, and you'd respond to the poll. That made the poll much more scientific. But now the response rate is about 8 or 9%. That means it's no longer scientific because you have an extra added layer in there called a response bias where you don't know who's not answering the phone. You don't know who's not answering your poll when they get on there. A lot of people now are very paranoid about identity theft. So if a total stranger calls you and starts asking you all these personal questions, you're much more likely to, you know, either not answer or to give the safe, politically correct answers because you don't want, you know, some government agency come knocking on your door being sent out by Hillary Clinton that you spoke against her. So there's all that going on and all these different biases going on, which shows that polling is broken. And just to add one thing, here's a perfect example. Investors Business Daily does a poll. It's been very successful the last three cycles. But a lot of people think that, well, you know, if they're doing the polls and they're getting these D plus 10, D plus 8 samples, then that's just what they're getting. And maybe they're telling us that the electorate really is heavily Democrat. But one thing I like about the IDBD poll is they not only give you the weighted sample, they give you the unweighted sample. They give you the raw numbers. And in their raw numbers for the last week and a half, every single poll, they have had an R plus sample in the raw sample, meaning when they're just calling people randomly, they're getting more Republicans answering than Democrats. It's been anywhere from R plus zero to R plus five. I think it was R plus five yesterday. Okay. So this is showing the electorate is moving right. It's a Republican sample out there. In every single instance, they have reweighted it to a D plus 7 to D plus 8 sample. So what they're doing is, for instance, they had an R plus 5 sample. They reweighted it to D plus 7. That's a 12-point gift to Hillary just to give her a 1 or 2-point lead. I'm telling you. And they're doing it, I think, people say, is this a conspiracy? Probably. You know, I mean, look at what we've seen in WikiLeaks, all these pollsters, all these different groups conspiring together to try to win this thing. So, yeah, I think it could be a conspiracy with the pollsters and the DNC.
Well, no, exactly. It came out in the WikiLeaks that it is a tactic that they formulated to, again, convince people that Hillary Clinton's doing a lot better than she is. Of course, after the first debate, we also saw this in the post-debate polls with CNN. I think it was 26%. Republicans versus something like 42% Democrats. The first debate was ridiculously overweighted in favor of Democrats. Of course, after every single debate, the CNN ORC poll said that Hillary Clinton won comfortably, even though the immediate reaction to the second debate, at least, was that Trump crushed her, even amongst, you know, some anti-Trump people, right?
Yeah. Well, here's the thing. As people always criticize these flash polls, you know, these post-debate flash polls like the Drudge poll and all these others, you know, they say, well, it's not scientific. Well, you know, none of them are scientific, but they say it's not scientific because it's not a random sample. Well, none of them are random samples. But when you get a like 95-5 win for Trump on these, let's say, for instance, the Drudge poll, what you got to remember is that poll is available to everybody. There is no barrier to entry to that poll. And unless you're willing to go through a lot of things with clearing your cookies and all this stuff on your browser, you can only vote once. Each person can only vote once because it records your IP address and doesn't allow you to vote twice. So this is a big win for Trump in these polls. Now, does that mean that Trump is going to win 95-5? No, but what it does do is it measures enthusiasm. It measures energy because that means those Trump supporters were energetic enough to go out there and to vote in that poll, and the Hillary voters were not that energetic. And you see that in the, you know, for instance, in the Republican primaries, I believe there were 12 debates. I think Trump only went to 11. Out of those, I believe that the scientific polls only had him winning one debate out of all of those. And yet the online flash polls had him winning every one. And guess who was the nominee 3-1? Trump. Okay. So the flash polls don't predict actual real numbers, but they do predict direction. They do predict enthusiasm. And enthusiasm really pays when it comes time to who the likely voter is. And a brand new poll just came out with People's Pundit Daily. No, it wasn't. Oh, this was the ABC poll. The ABC poll, in just the last week, the enthusiasm for Trump has gone to a 7-point lead. I'm telling you. and they're still polling D plus 10. You know, they're in for a big shock. They're in for a big shock.
The Rasmussen poll came out immediately after and said, you know, the FBI announcement has had no effect on this. But then you drilled down into it, and only on October 30 was one of the days where they did the poll. The other dates were before the FBI even made the announcement. Yeah. But again, with the debate polls, of course, they say, oh, well, that's trolls. That's the Russians who are voting for Trump. Well, Hillary's campaign admittedly paid trolls to go out on the internet and shill for her. That's a documented fact. So fine, there are trolls on Trump's side, but there are trolls on Hillary's side as well. I wanted to ask you in the final minute of this segment, we've got O'Keefe, he's got a new bombshell video set to drop. We've got WikiLeaks entering phase three of their release. On the flip side, we've got speculation, you know, about 9 hours of recordings of private Trump conversations. Do you think the behavior, the mannerism of the Clinton camp suggests that they do have some more dirt to release on Trump, or are they all out of ammo at this point?
I think, this is what I think, and Rush confirmed this today, and we've seen this from some other people. I think that the Democrat leadership has decided that they are actually better off with Trump winning this election. I know this sounds like a bombshell, but this is what I think. They're better off with Trump winning this election because they do not believe Trump will be a good president. Okay, they think he'll be a bad president. And they're not as afraid of it. You know what they're really afraid of? They're not that afraid of Trump. They're afraid of us. We're the movement. They're afraid of the movement. They want to kill the movement, okay? They're not worried about killing Trump. They want to kill the movement. And I think what they've decided is that the Clinton brand is so damaged at this point because it's not just the Hillary, but also the Clinton Foundation that's going to be having problems going forward, that they're better off with a Trump presidency and then try to destroy him as president and run somebody new, a new Barack Obama in 2020 and try to win back Congress in 2018.
We'll be back. Stick with that thought, Bill. We are back to the final segment of the Alex Jones Show. Before we go back to our guest, Bill Mitchell, just want to tell you about our other special at InfoWarsStore.com. It's the Pro Pure G2.0 King Gravity Water Filter. 30% off at InfoWarsStore.com. This is the flagship Pro Pure all-in-one gravity water filter. 30% off for a limited time at InfoWarsStore.com. It removes heavy metals, pesticides, herbicides, pharmaceutical, drug contaminants, fluoride, and so much more from your tap water. We've got lab results at InfoWarsStore.com. We've got five-star independent reviews. Everybody's using a water filter at this point. Get our ProPure 2.0 King Gravity Water Filter for 30% off at InfoWarsStore.com. And again, all your support goes to building this platform, to challenging the mainstream media directly. We couldn't have done it without you for the past, what, now near two decades. So we really encourage and appreciate your support by getting the products at InfoWarsStore.com. Going back to our guest here in the final couple of minutes, Bill Mitchell, you were talking before the break. Does the Democratic Party actually have it in their plans to sacrifice Hillary Clinton because they fear she could damage their brand to such a degree? I mean, we saw this with the British Labour Party back in the late 70s. They didn't get back into power for 18, 19 years based on a similar concern about damaging the brand. We see that now with Jeremy Corbyn to some extent. Finish up your quotes that you were saying before the break about, could they be holding back? Could they be sacrificing Hillary so as not to damage the brand of the Democratic Party?
I think they could be. We have some evidence like Barack Obama coming out and supporting Comey and what he's doing with releasing this email investigation. Also, the New York Times printing an article exonerating Trump from having any connections to Russia. I mean, these are very unusual things to be doing. Also, there seems to be some evidence out there amongst major players, Michelle Obama, Barack Obama, where it appears, at least in their Twitter feeds, that they may have unfollowed Hillary. I don't want to say that for sure, but there seems to be some evidence of that. So,
well, Michelle Obama's just deleted all her tweets since 2013, by the looks of it. So that's interesting what's going on there.
Yeah, she has her own FLOTUS, at FLOTUS account, which is her primary personal account. And then she has one that's sort of a super PAC account. And they're the ones that, the super PAC account is the ones that deleted the tweets since 2013. But here's my thinking on this, that Democrats are saying, you know, this Clinton brand is getting a little stale. It's a little worn out. And not only is Hillary Clinton under FBI investigation, but the Clinton Foundation is as well. And I understand that the Clinton, the FBI sought a grand jury against the Clinton Foundation, and the Department of Justice turned them down. So Hillary Clinton would be starting her presidency under a major cloud that would be very difficult for them and would empower us. See, they're worried about us. They're worried about the movement, and that would empower us. We would have an even bigger voice against them. And then if Hillary ended up getting indicted or she ended up being impeached, then that would be dramatically bad for them. Now, flip the tables here. Let's say they let Trump win. They don't do any of their cheats. They don't do any of the hacks that you guys were talking about on another show. They allow Trump to win. They throw Hillary under the bus, okay? Then what we can look at is that what's going to happen when Trump becomes president? Okay, they can become the opposition party. They can fight him every step of the way. They can use the media to try to make it look like everything he's doing is failing. Also, we're looking at a major stock market correction when Trump becomes president, because so much of the stock market is based upon these 0% interest rates that are ridiculous. You know, Trump.
It's amazing, Bill. We've run out of time. We'll be sure to get you back on. But again, amazing revelations, Bill. We will get you back on. It's yourvoiceradio.com and search for Bill Mitchell on Twitter. He's absolutely killing it. Again, 200 million impressions. He is the go-to guy when it comes to these polls. That's going to wrap it up for the Alex Jones Show. Be sure to join us again. Breaking news at Infowars.com.